and then we usually start off with a public forum, and that'd be a great time to stand up.
That's what I was.
All right, calling to order the public session of the Board of Selectmen for July 14th, 2015. I'd like to start the meeting with the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, the board's reconvening in public session now. We started off the evening in executive session where we discussed contract collective bargaining updates relative to police, fire, and dispatch. We discussed purchase, exchange, lease, or valuable property regarding property on Claflin Avenue, the Pratt Estate, Wyckoff parcel, and the parcels recommended by the Elementary School Building Committee. And that was actually the only two things we covered. The third item on the agenda was not discussed this evening. So we're going to open the meeting, as we always do, with the public session. Public forum, residents are invited to share ideas, opinions, or ask questions regarding town government. Do we have anyone who'd like to? Sir, you. Can I ask you to stand, step to the podium so they get on the camera, and then can you start off with your name and address, and then go right in?
I'm Dave Shea, 7 North Mill Street.
Okay.
I have a question about the single stream recycling. I saw it in the paper a few weeks ago. Is that going to come up again for reconsideration, or is that done?
So it was on the agenda last month. We had some discussion about it. We did not take action at that time. I think we're still working through it to see. There's a lot of questions, actually, and some concerns raised by the board. And so currently we're working through all that. And if we get that done, we'll try to have an agenda next month.
Okay, so it's not done, but it's not certain whether it's going to come up again?
Right. The timing of bringing it back up is uncertain and will be determined by when we come to conclusion on the, or we get some of the more answers that we were asking for last time. Okay?
Thank you.
The agendas are always posted the Friday before a meeting, so you should be able to know several days in advance. You can also sign up to get an email distribution list where the agendas get sent out to people, and so if you do that, you'll actually get it automatically forevermore. Thank you. Anybody else here for public forum with, hey, Ann, how are you? Hello.
My name is Ann Schick, and I am here as a friend of the Hopkinton University Celebration Group. We have, for the last 3 years, been raising funds for the celebration of the 300 years of the city of our town, and we are 6 months and 14 days into the celebration, and I would congratulate the town committee who has done a bang up job introducing many of the we have been raising money for 3 years, and some of our friends. His Eagle Scout project was to restore the train depot. So on Sunday from 11 to 2, Chris is going to be at the train depot and talking about his project, his Eagle Scout project. So we're very excited about that. And we are there now, Saturday and Sunday, right through November, selling merchandise, ambulance merchandise. I have one of our t-shirts on now. And I'd love to show you the decal that you can put on your cars. If anybody's interested, they're available. We have other merchandise there. And the reason I bring that up is because I don't expect people want to show up at the anniversary celebration weekend in September without even a t-shirt or a hat or a visor or a decal or walking around with a coffee mug. I can't imagine anyone wanting to miss out the opportunity. So we are at the depot Saturday and Sunday, 10 to 2. We also have merchandise online. Okay? So we also have a couple of other opportunities for people to see us. We are going to be at all the concerts on the Common with our merchandise. On the second Sunday of every month through October, we will be doing our bottle drive. As of now, we've raised almost $12,000. Collect bottles. And if you can do the math, which I can't, I've got a lot of bottles. And on, also the Friends is putting on the Lumberjack show. After the parade, after the celebration weekend, we're going to have one more activity on October 18th. And I think it would be a great way for folks to enjoy the fall weather, to do an activity that hasn't come to town that I know of for many, many, many years. And of course, then the ending of the celebration will be the beginning of December. So I'd like to remind folks that we are at the Train Depot. It's the Friends of Upcoming Anniversary Celebration, Saturday and Sunday from 10 to 2. And this weekend, the Eagle Scout, Chris Barron, will be there with us on Saturday. Thanks so much,
Ann.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
That $12,000 is about 240,000 bottles. I'm thinking maybe we should have brought them back to Michigan.
In a mail delivery.
Thank you for that. So noted. Anybody else for public forum? Okay. Actually, I do have one public forum thing I want to say, just to make folks in the community aware. So there have been a number of incidents of vandalism lately against Selectmen's homes. And so I'm not looking for sympathy here, but I just do want to point out the fact that that it's okay for everyone to disagree with things, in my opinion, and sometimes passions get high, but vandalizing people's homes is kind of beyond what I think what anyone would consider reasonable. So I just want to take this opportunity in public forum to say, whoever did that, you're an idiot and a coward. So moving right along. On to the consent agenda, action item. First item is minutes. The board will consider accepting the following public session minutes: March 17th, April 7th, April 28th, May 19th, and June 2nd, 2015. Second is election worker reappointments. An action item, the board will consider reappointing the town clerk's election workers, and there's a list attached as an exhibit. Third item is a notice of taking. The board will consider a notice of taking relative to the street acceptances from Article 54 from the 2015 annual town meeting. There's also a notice of taking there. Four is gifts. The board will accept $120 in donations from three anonymous donors in memory of Ray Draw to the Hopkinton Veterans Celebration Committee. Five is change of hours, Yogurt Beach. The board will consider approving a change in closing hours for Yogurt Beach on Sunday through Thursday from 9 to 10 p.m., an adjustment extension of 1 hour. And six is a resignation. The board will accept the resignation of Ronald H. Eldridge from the Capital Improvement Committee, effective immediately. Would anyone like to break any of those items out?
Mr. Chair, 5 and 6, please.
Okay, we have a request to break out items 5 and 6. Any others? Okay, Chair, I'll entertain a motion to approve items 1 through 4 of the consent agenda.
Second.
Motion second. Further discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Present not voting. That passes unanimously. Mr. Herr, over to you for number 5.
Number 5, specific to Yogurt Beach, moving the hours from 9 p.m. to 10 p.m. Sunday through Thursday. Has there been any discussion from any neighbors, any input from anyone specific to this request at all that we know of?
Go, Mr. Kamala.
Yeah, through the chair, I'm not aware of any discussions with the neighbors. However, I also wanted to point out that today we received an amended request from Yogurt Beach. They are proposing that they shift the closing hours from 9 p.m. to 11 p.m.
That was my question. So,
I believe it was 11 p.m. every night.
Every night, 7 nights a week.
Yep.
Okay, so just to recap where we are here. So the agenda says 9 to 10. The most recent update, which was Sunday through Thursday, now they want to go till 11 p.m. every night of the week, is the request before the board, right?
Yes.
Okay. Discussion.
I was leaving here at 9 o'clock on Monday night after one of the meetings that I had to attend, or three of the meetings, and it was great to actually have something open. You know, usually Bill's is already closing and everything, and I stopped by and I got some yogurt, and you know, to have it open at 10 when we sometimes close up meetings to go over and get a dessert or something, or at 11 o'clock, I think would be a great thing. we're looking for vibrancy downtown, and to actually have one place that stays open, and then maybe the pizza place will stay open, and maybe Bill's will stay open another hour, and we'll actually start getting some of the vibrancy that we've been looking for, instead of the sidewalks being rolled up at 8 o'clock at night.
I agree. I've stopped by this business a couple times, and first of all, I mean, the product is delicious. Unfortunately, I had a couple of times where I got the craving, and it was after they closed. But another hour, I think, would be great. And if a business feels that it's viable for them, and it's not something that's going to be disturbing.
The microphone's on.
Yeah, I have it on.
No.
If it's not something that's going to be disturbing the neighbors, then I'm all for it. You know, let them thrive.
So just to understand, so are you going for 10 or 11? Because the request on the agenda is to 10. The request as of this afternoon was for 11. And
yeah.
So I just want us to understand where we're
at. I'm fine with 11.
You're fine with 11.
Because one of the things is that one of the ways that they were actually talking about is that they would be really staying open, and then the close up and everything else. And if there are people still sitting in there, they didn't want to rush them out.
Okay.
Anything? So 9 to 11 is a little different than 9 to 10. I'm fine with them staying open later. That's not the issue. I just want to make sure that abutters or those in the area have had an opportunity to speak on the issue. I'd be okay saying, yes, let's do this. But if it presents a problem, that we revisit it at some point in the future. If we say yes today, that doesn't grandfather it from now into perpetuity, does it?
Mr. Kamala, what was the extended closing time that we recently approved for the restaurant across the street?
It was until, I believe, 10 p.m. Even during that discussion, we did note that previously that this had been open until 11 p.m.
So 11?
My only question is, go ahead, let you finish.
That's it.
The only thing I want to point out is they're asking for it also 7 days a week. So, I mean, do we want to go for this every night? Just to raise the topic.
I mean, it's
ice cream.
It's a restaurant. It's a restaurant that people are going to.
Just trying to make clear what we're signing on for. Yeah. So the request is 7 days a week till 11 p.m. That's
I guess if Bittersweet was saying they wanted to stay open till 11, would we be saying, people might get kind of wild?
So Chair will entertain a motion.
So moved.
What's the motion?
Okay. To approve a change of closing hours for Yogurt Beach on Sunday, on Monday,
every day
from 9 p.m. to 11 p.m.
Okay, so we have a motion.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Do we have further discussion? Just to be clear, we can revisit this if we get complaints, right? So we should be attentive to. I just don't want to disrupt the folks in the neighborhood, especially my only concern is like Sunday nights, things like that. I don't want to be.
Yes.
We got to be attentive to this.
Yes, the board has the ability to do that. Also, annually we receive license renewal requests, and that's another opportunity for the board to review this. For the record, we did receive comments from all the permitting offices, and they were in favor of the request.
All right. Well, we'll do this as a test drive. All right. So no further discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Present? Not voting. That's unanimous. Okay, item number six. Mr. Herr, also over to you.
Item number six. I just wanted to take a minute and thank Mr. Eldridge for his years and years, if not decades, of service to the community. To have him resign without us acknowledging his incredible contribution, I don't think would be fair. I certainly would like to see the board extend a letter of thanks to Mr. Eldridge on behalf of the community. But that was the reason to break it up.
Good. No, I'm glad you did, by the way, because Ron got me started in town politics, and so actually he was the chair of the Appropriations Committee for many years, including when I was first on. So Ron has done, I think, you know, decades actually, literally, of service. 12 years in the Appropriations Committee, 5 or 6 years since then on other committees. He's been a spectacular contributor to town. I also want to point out his wife Marie has been a spectacular contributor to town, helped draft the original charter. The Eldridges are great folks who I think we should make clear are always welcome in Hopkinton. So, okay. So with that, Chair will entertain a motion to accept the resignation of Ron Eldridge from the Capital Improvement Committee effective immediately.
Second.
Second. Further discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Present? Not voting. That's unanimous. And we will send that letter as you requested.
Thank you.
Okay. Moving right along here, item number four on the agenda, updates on proposed CVS 61 Main Street discussion item. The board will give an update on questions asked at the previous meeting and discuss any additional questions or action items. Okay, so... Last meeting, we had a lengthy discussion about the CVS that's proposing to go on the former Fred Colella's. At the end of that discussion session, we created a list of questions, both from board members and from members of the public, that we asked the town council to go off and answer. The town council did draft a memo back with answers to that questions, and Mr. Kamala, we posted that this afternoon, right? So that's out there publicly available for folks. Yes?
Yes.
Okay, good. So what I would like to do at this point is I would like to, first of all, go to the board and then see if any board members have any further questions, comments they want to make about this process. Then we'll go for a somewhat less lengthy, compared to last time, session for questions from members of the public. And then we are going to hold this pretty tightly to 7:30. We'll decide what next steps the board wants to take. So let me start off by going over to Mrs. Sestari. You want to open this up?
I read through the answers to the questions, the memo from town council, and Mr. Chairman, I do not have any questions regarding what it states or the meaning.
Okay. Over to you, Mr. Herr. Do you have anything to say?
Well, I've had a chance to go through the comments and responses from Mr. Mieres. That's a public document now. I'm sure others have had a chance to look at it, too. I hope they have. I'm interested in hearing the comments from the public tonight and then see if there's anything we can do to further the process one way or another. But I think it's important to get more feedback before we take any action.
Okay. Over to you, Mr. Catino.
Yeah, I concur. It's I think one of the things that we have to do, I don't know how much, if we should take some more public comment before some of my statements, but I just want to say that I, too, was disappointed when I first heard that CVS was moving into a spot that I thought would have been perfect for a marathon sports. Or an REI sports or something to go along with the vision statements. I worked on the visioning committee for almost a year. And, in there, we've got it right there that we're endowed with open space, natural resources, facilities and programs that promote a well-educated and healthy community. And, I just thought that would have tied everything in. And, we're doing a yeoman's job, the group is doing a yeoman's job of going after as much as they can with the permits and licensing and everything. But I think one of the things that we have to start doing is actually talking business to business with people from Crosspoint and CVS. I own businesses, and maybe just sit down with them and ask them, is it possible to move 3/4 of a mile to the east or the west, to the intersection of 495 or maybe Legacy Farms, and have another developer buy the Colella's property at a fair market value. And then is it possible for the Board of Selectmen maybe to sit down and talk TIFs, if people all work out. And then we end up with a win-win-win so that the downtown is what we're looking for. People get the buildings they want because, CVS might want to have that prototypical CVS with the facades and everything else. And, and then everybody sort of wins. But no matter what, we really have to sit down and talk. Right now we're on opposite sides of a wall. And with CVS and Crosspoint and us, and I think it's just important to again, Chairman Palaco sat down with them at one point. But I think that we have to continue these discussions and see, give them another avenue to maybe reconsider or something, and then talk about the land takings that we need to do and everything else because we won't really need a win-win-win.
Good. Thank you for that. So I'm just going to, because I'm not sure everyone got the chance to read the memo, I'm not going to read the memo, which is 8 pages long, but I'm just going to summarize the questions that were answered just so folks know. And to the extent there's anything specific, we have the town council here, we can pick it up that way. So 7 or 8 broad sets of questions that were answered by the town council. The first was questions regarding the property acquisition and lease, and that reflects the town council's review of the publicly filed documents about it. Second is questions regarding notice of the town, which basically says, I think, what we all told you all before, which is we found out the same day everyone else did. The third regards questions regarding the current condition of the building, which goes to issues of fit out and what they're doing inside there. Fourth, it goes to questions regarding actions by the building inspector, and there's a summary there. Fifth is questions regarding the liquor license. Six is questions regarding zoning, and that relates to CVS classification under the zoning laws, as well as Hopkinton Drugs classification under the zoning laws, process for sign changes, being the third item. Seventh is questions regarding future options, and that is all of the broad topics. So with that, let me open it up to members of the public. As I did last time, I'll ask, can we try to keep the comments concise? Can we go to specific questions as opposed to broad-ranging commentary? And we'll see if we can get answers and work our way through this. I'm sorry. So, right, protocol, name and address. Everyone's got to give name and address. And only, and again, just like, no, it's okay. And just like last time, again, I'd ask everyone come up to the podium to ask a question, the only exception being, as you can tell, we have some hearing impaired members tonight who can ask questions from wherever they stand or through the interpreter if they choose. Please, I'm sorry.
Emily Struzik, 93 Front Street. I see that Town Council's discovery was sent to the Board of Selectmen on July 8th. I was sent this at approximately 6:40 or 5:45 tonight. I haven't had the week that you all had to review this document, but I would like to have an opportunity to do so because I just saw it. I don't know if there can be another time. Time is of the essence in this issue, but I would appreciate a discussion perhaps about that. And then I also would just like to know how you propose to address the liquor license violations.
Right. So on the first one, honestly, whether it goes in the agenda for next month, we have one meeting a month in the summer. So next meeting will be August 15th or something. I don't actually know the exact day. So whether it goes in that agenda will depend upon what else there is to do. I mean, just to be frank about it. So that's the first answer. The second answer is the liquor license violation is not necessarily related to the Cross Point purchase. It's actually by the way, I want to make clear, it's not been determined, I think, conclusively there is a violation. We're still reviewing the information. But to the extent there is anything, it would be by the current holder of the license. So it's really sort of tangential to the CVS and Cross Point conversation. What I will say on that is the board is still gathering and reviewing information. To the extent that we're concerned there has been a violation, what the board will do would be to call a public hearing. I think we'd probably also do that the next meeting, quite honestly. So that will, to the extent there's anything to pick up, will get picked up in August as well. Okay? Good.
May I ask one last
question? Of course.
So individuals on the No CVS committee, I believe, have spoken with attorneys who, from what I've gathered, have a very different outlook on this argument. Is there any room to get a second opinion without causing offense to individuals in this room, Mr. Miarez?
He's used to it. He's
a lawyer. Lawyers are thick skin.
He's probably heard worse since dinner time. So I think it's yeah, no. We get it, right? No one feels good about this. We all want to review everything we can. And so we're absolutely open-minded. And if you do have something, please do send it along. I promise you we'll read it, and we'll review it, and we'll see what comes of it. So we're extremely open-minded to taking anything. All right? Good. Does anybody have anything else? All right.
Cindy Altamira, Elm Street. I think CVS is one issue. I just wanted to really just make a comment. I think as a town, we are at a crossroads. I think we've let things go as they're going to tumble down without taking some real directive. If we don't want to see chains, if we don't want to see CVS in the center of town, maybe Dennis saying, forget this, I don't need this, and it becoming a dollar store, or somebody buying two or three businesses and putting in Burger King. I think we need to look at some long-range planning. I think, John, we should be looking at Zach, seeing what we can do to stop or limit chains. We've already got two that have jumped in, and right now I think there's been an atmosphere in town that any business that comes in, no matter where, is good, and we're going to rubber stamp it. We're going to run over people's feelings. We're going to run over neighbors. We're going to not worry about streetscape. We're not going to worry about lighting. We're not going to worry about the town that we're all invested in. And we're just going to say, yay, it's another business or another development or another strip mall, and we're rubber stamping it. If we don't want this to continue, then we as a town have to step back and decide what we really do want. How do we want our character to progress for the next 20, 50 years? What are we saying about ourselves? Do we want to be another Bellingham or Needham or a Weston or a Sudbury? We have to decide the kind of town we want to be, and we have to draft zoning that fits what we as a town want. I hope Mr. Mieres can give us some guidance, because we have to go by what's going to be accepted by the Attorney General, what's approved and what's not, what we have a right to do and what we don't have a right to do. Just like if you don't want a certain neighbor to come next door, if you don't own the house, you don't get to say who moves there. It's the same thing with our zoning. If you don't want a certain type of business, if you don't want to see a town develop a certain way, then you have to make sure that you have lighting and you have setbacks and you have heavy landscaping and you have zoning in place that's going to prevent it, which means that people have to get their rear ends to town meeting and vote it up or down, because it all comes down to town meeting and a two-thirds vote. So when we spend years working on zoning and nobody shows up and it's the third night and everybody's tired and you only get the developers and their friends who vote for it, that's what we get as a town. So if you don't want to see this continue, and it's going to continue, then get yourselves to town meeting and back the zoning that's being proposed if you feel it's right for the town. And we can use more volunteers.
Okay. I'm actually going to see Sandy and take it one further. So many of the issues she raised right now, I think you all know, are planning board, ZAC, CBA issues. So again, I think that's a group that people need to engage with. But I will say, and this is a little bit of a pitch from my end, in my opinion at least, a lot of the issue here is doesn't go to vision, because we've done a lot of visioning in this town. We have a vision statement. We have all these documents we've created. The real challenge, just so everyone, again, this is sort of based upon my experience here, the real challenge is execution. And this is part of what we were hoping to do with the assistant town manager that the board brought forth at last town meeting. You all may recall we put an assistant town manager in the budget. It got to town meeting floor, and then we had a small set of folks stand up and argue against it. But the reason this matters is because what we need, I believe, what we need in this town is a person on our payroll who can be tasked with going out and trying to make sure that businesses and things we bring to town fit with the vision that the town has. Part of the reason this happened, right, is because we didn't know what was going on. We weren't able to engage with anybody beforehand and just sort of showed up as a fait accompli. If we had an individual who could spend at least some of their time doing outreach to businesses that fit with the town's vision, recruiting those kind of companies, or at least making them aware of the opportunity in Hopkinton, being able to talk to people about the demographics and all the other attributes that would make this attractive for businesses, I think we'd have much more success in proactively bringing folks here that we want, as opposed to reactively just having people show up and hoping and we like them. This is, that to me is the great problem in this whole situation. Structurally, the town has no capability right now at all, because nobody has the bandwidth, to do that kind of work. That's how communities shape themselves the way they want to. Otherwise, whether or not we have zoning or something else, we're always going to be on the back foot. We're always going to have people showing up who we may not want. And we're going, as you're learning right now, we're going to have grave challenges trying to deal with it after the fact. So I will say to you that I don't know what the budget's going to look like next year. And I don't know if the board will ask to bring forward an assistant town manager again. But I will tell you that this is the kind of role we need. And I do hope that if we get to that point, that members of the community will remember this and appreciate the fact that that's the kind of thing we think we need and hopefully go for it the next town meeting. So, yes, sir.
If I could also just add on to what you've said and tag on to Sandy's comments. In the end, she aptly made the statement that people need to get up and they need to get involved. And getting involved isn't just on town meeting night, two night, three nights. But it is, because that's not when all those motions are created for different zoning articles, but it's being involved throughout the year, running for planning board or board of selectmen or whatever you're interested in, and or just going to the meetings and saying, hey, look, you know, we want a zoning article that's going to prevent big box stores, you know, whatever you're looking to accomplish, and having people listen to you and you know, use your voices then. But it can't just be on the three nights of the year. You know, it's got to be active participation throughout the year.
Ma'am, you had a question.
Ann Boschel, Six Angel Gray. I really appreciate Sandy's point. And it's, the CVS issue has enlightened me and I think many others. I want to point out that this room is filled with people that are involved in the process, not just three nights a week during town meeting. But it takes more than the town involvement, because what we need is town officials or town employees to actually follow through on the bylaws that are passed. When I sat in this room 2 weeks ago, it came to light that there were questions about the zoning bylaws, and you, the board, agreed that we need to look into how the zoning bylaws could be or applied to CVS Pharmacy. The next day, on Wednesday, I came into the same building and I asked to see the permit applications. The permit application for CVS to come to town and do the interior renovations, the permit application that let us all know that CVS was coming, had not yet been approved on Wednesday, the day after the meeting, where it became clear that how the bylaws should be applied were in question. The next day, our zoning enforcement officer approved the permit. I assume he knew that the application of the bylaw was in question, and if he didn't know, that's also a problem. But I don't understand how that action could have been taken, knowing that a whole town is questioning the application of the bylaw, and I am interested to learn what the oversight process is for zoning. And since we're at the Board of Selectmen meeting, I would like to know what your role is in making sure that our bylaws are being followed by not only businesses, but also our town employees.
Okay. Thank you. Ray, can you talk to the assertion that the bylaw wasn't followed properly? And can you talk to the building inspector's permit issuance validity? I think those are the two. Your opinion of the validity of his permit, and then also the question about whether he acted in accordance with the bylaws.
Sure. Well, to begin with, the building inspector didn't act in a vacuum. He certainly was aware of the challenges. He had considered them. I had been asked about them. I think I was pretty clear 2 weeks ago that I did not believe that this was a health services facility. I communicated that to the building inspector, so he was not acting in a vacuum. and he did consider other points of view before rendering his decision. Second, the building inspector, under our bylaws, is the zoning enforcement officer. And this board, the Board of Selectmen, has no oversight over that. He derives his power from the bylaw and from the state statute that requires us to designate a zoning enforcement officer, or by default it is the building inspector. So our bylaw, in fact, designates him as the zoning enforcement officer. There is a process. It's not as though he goes without any oversight. His oversight is from the Zoning Board of Appeals. And there is a process for appealing his decisions if anyone is aggrieved by it. It's mentioned in my memo that they can bring it to the Zoning Board of Appeals. The Zoning Board of Appeals will hold a public hearing, take all points of view, and can issue a decision overruling the building inspector. But that's the process that exists, and it's separate and distinct from the authority of the Board of Selectmen.
So let me just repeat what I think I heard, just so I understand. So if there's a debate about the issuance of a permit, the pathway is to appeal to the ZBA, which can then overrule the building inspector's decision if they choose?
Yes.
So they have the statutory authority, I guess, to do that. Okay.
Almost. Can you tell me what individuals and bodies and groups or what have you have the right to appeal a permit or a permit approval?
I can describe it generally through you, Mr. Chairman.
Please.
A person who is aggrieved, and that's a legal term, means that you are in some way harmed by the decision, can do it, as well as municipal boards can appeal it if they so choose.
So you keep going?
Okay, that's it.
Oh, so how high is the bar for aggrieved? I mean, can anybody who's...
Generally speaking, the Zoning Board of Appeals would... it would be unusual for them to determine that somebody who went through the trouble of filing an appeal was not aggrieved, but I suppose that somebody could be so far away. But usually when you see these appeals, it's usually brought by people who are either within the same zoning district or very close by.
Okay. Any more? Of course. Yeah, I mean, I'm trying to keep us on track, but until then. I mean, unless someone else is in line.
Thank you.
Are you good? Okay.
Okay, Emily Struzik, 93 Front Street, again. I have two questions for Mr. Miarez. When you were asked by the inspector your opinion about this use determination, had you done any research on the matter at that point?
When I was asked or when I answered?
When you were asked and when you were answered.
Well, when I...
When you were when asked I and when you were
so just to be clear, right, Ray only researches things in response to questions.
Right.
So I think he's just making sure, you know, he doesn't just go run around doing research for no reason.
Because I believe the permit was issued 2 days after the BOS meeting, so it had been a couple days.
So when I answered the question, yes, I satisfied myself. I had done the necessary research and had formulated an opinion.
And then my second question is, when you were conducting your discovery research, did you look at all for support of this this health services bylaw question that we had, or were you really only looking for ways to refute it?
Not really fair, right? Okay. that's sort of a leading question. I think the right way to ask it would be, did you do a broad-based search of precedents to make yourself comfortable that you were reflecting the general accepted legal conclusion.
Okay.
I just don't want, you know what I'm saying? Like, I don't, it's not, we don't want, this isn't one of those have you stop beating your wife kind of things. Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah.
When we do research, we, one of the things that we do is we look at other case law, other cases. Since this is zoning, we don't generally look outside of Massachusetts because our Massachusetts zoning laws are quite unique and not very similar to what you see in other states. We did identify a couple of cases in from the land court where pharmacies of this sort were seem to be have been assumed to be retail uses. It's not we did not find any case in which they there was a specific holding a pharmacy is a retail use, but we did find a couple of cases where it seemed to be assumed as part of the court's logic. The term health services facility that appears in our zoning bylaw is somewhat unique, and it has a definition that we were not able to find other examples anywhere else. So looking at how that term is defined in other contexts didn't strike us as being particularly useful. But the first rule of interpreting our bylaw is that words should be given their ordinary meaning unless there's some reason to give it some different meaning. And so the cases where pharmacies were regarded as essentially assumed to be retail uses seem persuasive to us. We did spend a fair amount of time reading corporate materials, but at the end of the day, we think that the most important characteristic of a store like CVS for zoning purposes is you know what kinds of transactions go on there and what sort of land use impacts does it have. So the fact that the corporation is well integrated into the healthcare market is not directly relevant to what goes on the ground here in Hopkinton.
Are you good?
Yes, thank you. And I apologize for my leading question. I did not mean for it to come out like that.
As the chair noted, I've heard worse since.
Good evening. Muriel Kramer, 39 North Street. I've had the happy opportunity to serve on the Board of Appeals as well as on this board. I have one first question. What is the window of opportunity to appeal the building inspector's decision?
July 23rd is the deadline.
July 23rd is the deadline. So I would just suggest to this gathered body that I've also had the opportunity to work with Mr. Meares, who is a terrific resource to this town, and I have a lot of respect for his work and the work of all the boards. But he might not be the resource for opponents to ask their questions for the action they might want to take. So your best energy quickly is to get legal advice from someone who is not balancing the needs of the legal needs of the town as well as the legal inquiries of the opponents. So really your best resource is to hire an attorney that listens to your concerns and decides whether or not he or she can argue your concerns in this venue.
Thanks, Muriel. Anybody else?
Hi. Karen O'Neill, Ledgestone Drive. I just wanted to kind of ask the question relating to, you know, I felt like at the last Board of Selectmen's meeting, we heard a lot about veils of darkness. And now I'm hearing Board of Selectmen talk about walls that have been constructed. I don't think anybody in this room, we've been the victims of walls and veils and whatever we want to, you know, come up with in terms of our anecdotes. What this group has done has been working tirelessly to find a legitimate issue and to that is giving us that time to pause and have the conversations that others are not seeming to come to the table and want to have. So, and when you've got the New York Times on any given day, this is this weekend, how CVS quit smoking and grew into the largest healthcare company in the country. CVS is arguably the country's biggest healthcare company, bigger than drug makers and wholesalers, and bigger than the insurers. So I respectfully request that the board allow us to use this. This is not unlike any precedent. We can't go looking in other towns and other cities and what pharmacy sales are. This is there's nothing else like this. And we have asked the town to allow us to use this point to have the pause so that we're not full steam ahead signing every zoning board and signing everything that comes up so that we can have the conversations and see if we can come up with a better solution. And we're not getting the support that we need from our elected town officials, and that's very frustrating because this group has worked very hard and this is not a normal company. So is it going to be an answer? I don't know. But it's enough to have a pause, and it's very upsetting that the town cannot see that and is not supporting it from a council standpoint, from zoning, from permits. I just don't understand.
So I respect your strongly held opinions, but I will say I don't think anything the board has done has shown lack of interest or support or willingness to engage in the project. I think in fact we've spent hours on this, actually. We've looked at all. We've had Ray spend hours of his time, several memos. I deny the assertion that there's been no willingness to pursue this or look for avenues. I just think the simple fact of the matter is we haven't really found any. So it's not for lack of desire. Nobody sitting up here says there's no pro CVS buttons on the board. We just haven't, quite frankly, found a rationale, whether it's in any regard, to take any action, or by the way, legal powers that enable us to do that. I mean, you just heard 5 minutes ago that we can't do anything about the building inspector issuing the permit. He doesn't work for us. So again, I want to...
You have to do something other than talk about walls and veils. I mean, that's what we're electing you for.
Well... Well, with all due respect, I think you're hopefully reluctant us for more than that. I think, again, we have, let's not forget, we don't get to do whatever we want. We have a charter, we have bylaws,
right.
We have precedents, we have a host of things, all of which we have to operate within. And so, this doesn't mean that we're not willing to do anything. It does mean, however, we can't do everything.
But we can pause.
Well, no, we can't, because we don't have the authority to pause.
Mr. Chairman, I'd also like to note that CVS, like a lot of other companies, is a conglomerate. They do a lot of things, and when it all comes together, then the capital CVS, may indeed be deemed a healthcare company. But when you start looking at the business that's being done inside the four walls over at the former Koala's, that's what we need to be concerned with. So. They're talking about putting retail, they're talking about putting pharmacy, they specifically said that they're not putting in Minute Clinic and things of that nature. This isn't the CVS that is we have to look at what they are acting as within those four walls, and I think that that's what we've asked town council to do, and it's not saying that you shut the door on any other possibilities. But that's what we have to look at. So when
the New York Times prints an article with the grander vision, we can look at United Health Group, and United Health Group is not just an insurer. United Health Group is also a software company and things of that nature. But people don't lump them into saying that. It's a software company when the New York Times or the Wall Street Journal is right.
I'm going to go over to Brian because he was asking.
But we have store sales figures. So
I have to ask, no back and forth except for the chairman, and I'm trying to make this be productive. So I appreciate your comment. I understand it. I sense your frustration. Is there anything else we can answer? Okay. We do need to move along, so I'm going to let you go because you're in line. Just before I do, though, is there anyone else who hasn't been up to the podium yet who wants to come? Because I do want to make sure everybody gets at least one chance to speak.
Yeah.
Okay, you got a question?
They
Meredith Wolcott, Hazel Road. With all the information about Board of Appeals, where is the building inspector in all this? Why are they not involved in this? I mean, they are behind the scenes, but, you know, it would be nice to have someone here as a voice. You know, I feel like it's great talking to you all, but, you know, ultimately, if you can't really do that much, you know, where are all the town officials?
The next, the group you should engage with, I think, and Mr. Coutinho can tell me if I'm wrong, is the Zoning Board of Appeals.
Right.
Which is the group, as we talked about earlier, that can actually overturn the building inspector's issuance of a permit. That's the group you need to go to. Am I?
Yeah, that's true. And when we're talking about a pause, you know, by filing that appeal, the appeal process time is that 20 days. But by the time they get to hear you, that could be that time of the pause, you know, because we do have to work within the law. And there are times when boards in this town have acted outside the law and have been sued. And I don't think the town has won a single suit. I may be mistaken, but we don't do very well. But that's the thing. So we may have the time that we're looking for during that appeals process. That's why it is very important to go through the ZBA and go and get there, because that's where the building's. He actually sits right there during the meetings.
But my fear is just, you know, and what we've talked about before is that the building inspector seems to be giving out permits, not willy-nilly, but not, you know, what's stopping him to say he's, you know, okay is the entire project and we have no course to act upon? Like, that's just my fear is that, you know, we have to wait a month for each of these meetings and, you know, time is of the essence. So what can we put in place that, you know, can give us somewhat of a pause, but...
Again, I think we just answered that. I mean, I think the pathway for you is to the ZBA. Yeah.
The ZBA.
And starting that appeal process does pause that.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
First, I'd like to say I wish I could answer your question about where zoning is, but they don't respond to my emails, so I'm not really sure.
So, again, can we, I need to keep wrap
moving,
this up.
I know.
So.
I'm just a little miffed by okay. it. So, anyway, I agree that CVS is kind of like a healthcare octopus, and this tentacle might be
okay, that's outside the bounds
different
of conversation.
From another one.
I've asked for
no. I am. He's saying it's a big company that does a lot of different things.
Okay.
And we don't know necessarily what's going into the CVS pharmacy aside from the signage. So I would like to know if anybody has reached out to CVS to find out what their planned use is. I have never had a business, but I assume that the people that are approving my business would want to know how I'm going to use, like what I'm going to be doing in this space. So I'm wondering, has there been any outreach to find out, okay, at this particular location, what are the activities you'll be engaging in out of CVS's mouth or CrossPoint, because it's CrossPoint's.
So again, they filed all the all the required information in the permits that have been issued.
I've seen that, and I have not seen anything related to use. I've just seen...
I think as long as it falls within the zoning bylaws, they're covered. Yeah.
Okay, so they don't have to ask. They can just assume, they guess, based on other CVS locations.
As long as they're within the existing zoning, they're fine.
Okay, so they actually don't know, aside from their own personal experience with CVS Pharmacy, is what you're saying, assuming. Because I've looked at the permit. I don't see anything...
Correct.
Okay. Also, I have looked at Town Council's document that was supplied to us late this afternoon. I've also looked at a lot of other information that, as a group, we've found as a community. And I know that we've sent the board a great deal of that information. And there's a mismatch. And I'm just asking, I'm hoping that you guys have read that information you have. And so... I've put it out on Facebook, and if you don't have it, let me know. But so I'm just going to skip the overview and let you know that considering the information that we've found, we're asking the board to compel the revocation of CVS Pharmacy Interior Renovation Building Permit number B342-15 and not to issue any more permits for the fit-out of this CrossPoint tenant unless they conform to our bylaws. And short of that, I would like to point out that the Board of Selectmen does have the right and responsibility to compel the revocation of this permit by following the appeals process you just described. And I know you have all that information.
All right. Okay. Thank you. Over to town council for a quick commentary.
One clarification. I should never be asked to do math on the fly, but the correct calculation, the permit was issued on the 25th of June. It's 30 days. 30 days from the 25th of June is the 25th of July, not the 23rd.
Thank you. Okay. Sir, you get the last
question. Paul P. from 67 Front Street. And my point is related to Ann's last comment. So I think the CVS committee understands the process that the next step, and as advised by the board, could be to raise this up with its own Board of Appeals. The committee has brought forth a lot of information that I think is can be used to sort of make that case. From a practical point of view, if you read the zoning the bylaws, anyone including the Board of Selectmen can take up that appeal. From a practical point of view, those bylaws also suggest that before bringing a case to that board, which is predominantly a legal board, it recommends retaining counsel. The committee has spent perhaps the last couple of weeks trying to find pro bono other attorneys to bring that case forward have not been able to. So the practical matter is, in order for the committee to bring this forward, they would need to raise on the order of $2,000 to $3,000 for that one next step. So that's why we implore the Board of Selectmen, having the funds of the town, can bring this forward to the Zoning Board of Appeals. It really is not practical for the committee to bring that forward. A second point I'd like to make is, I've heard, I think even at the prior meeting, that there's a financial risk to the town. I would posit that at any step along the way, the town can decide to move forward to the next step or not. So really what we're asking is on the order of $2,000 to $3,000, perhaps even less. I don't know what our town council's hourly rate is, but I would really implore that in order to really bring this forward from a practical matter, the Board of Selectmen needs to take this forward. And then further, what I would request this evening, since that appeal would need to be put in place before the next Board of Selectmen meeting, I would also request on behalf of the committee for the Board of Selectmen to take an official vote, so at least there's transparency as far as who on the Board of Selectmen is willing to take that matter forward or not.
Okay. Thank you for your request. Okay, so I'm going to go back to the board now for comments before we wrap up. So over to you, John.
Actually, to answer the question about using Ray Miaris for the anti-CVS, I believe that he's actually used by the ZBA to be a mediator, so to speak. I don't know, Ray, if you could discuss that. It'd be tough for a lawyer to argue both sides, so I don't know if it was possible to hire Ray.
Usual practice when one board or official challenges the action of another board of official is that town council steps back and the town hires two lawyers, one for each side.
May I add something to that?
Actually, no. We're 20 minutes over. We need to move along. Your request is recognized. I know what you want.
But I have one other
I don't want to keep going.
Again, I just want to say that during whatever pause we get, I implore Crosspoint and CVS to come sit down with us, the boards, and let's talk business to business, because that's money talks, and you know, to try and get them to see what they're going to do, what we can do together, and try and make this a win-win-win. That's what I'm trying to get at.
Mr. Herr.
So I believe this is the longest I've ever sat quiet at a selectman meeting in my life.
But I've done a lot of listening tonight and thinking about this issue over the last couple of weeks. A couple of points came up that I'd like to address and then talk a little bit more in generic terms. Specific to, somebody asked a question about the license and you touched on it briefly, the liquor license. You know, our goal here is to make that right, not to be punitive about what's going on. So we have to figure out how to do that, if that requires a hearing or something like that. Maybe we'll look at that. I don't know, but I know you've tried to clarify whether or not there's been a violation. We don't know if there's a violation. We determine that after a hearing.
Right.
And the goal is not to, at least from this seat, be punitive about that, but to make that license correct and right going forward so it can continue without any interruption. Specific to Mr. Mary's point, and I think it was just in this dialogue here a minute ago too, specific to the that municipal boards can appeal the zoning enforcement officer. So you are saying, Mr. Chair, through you, you're saying that this board could take a vote to file an appeal on behalf of the community to reverse the building inspector's permit issuance, correct?
Yes.
Okay. But that would require us getting additional counsel, given the fact that you'd have to recuse.
Probably two. One to advise the Board of Appeals, as well as one to represent the appellant.
Oh, so you would step out of the entire discussion on either side?
That's right.
Gotcha. Okay. Okay. So those are my two specific questions or points that came up based on what I heard tonight. You know, I still am where I was 2 weeks ago. I don't believe that this is a good fit for the community. I don't like the manner in which it was sprung upon us. To Mr. Catino's point, I think it's imperative that we talk to any major stakeholders in the community about plans so that we can facilitate and make better all that would be involved in some kind of development, and certainly development at the crossroads of the community. The property in question has been under discussion for years, if not decades, specific to straightening the intersection and trying to do that in a way that was respectful to the existing business, but always deferring to the existing business so as not to make that, you know, a situation they didn't want to inherit or bring on. But with the change of the land now comes the opportunity, and I think that's where a lot of my frustration is in this process, is that we've not had an opportunity to have a meaningful, true discussion about how to take into account municipal needs that we've talked about for years, including straightening the intersection, off-street parking, streetscape plans that we're working on, the 25% plan we're working on with the state right now, and we could go on with a few other items. So we have to find a way to bring the municipal needs that have been long tabled into this discussion. And we're going to do that one of two ways, at least from my seat. We're going to do that working together. We're going to do that, you know, however we got to do that. So I'd prefer that we work together to solve those municipal needs. But I'm convinced that now is the time, as difficult and as uncomfortable as it may be, now is the time to address those needs. It's good for the people in the center of town. It's good for our school buses. It's good for the moms and dads getting kids back and forth. It's good for the businesses in the area that we fix this municipal need that we've talked about forever. And why we didn't discuss it last year or the year before when all this was going down, I don't know. But, you know, the water's under the bridge now. Let's move on. So that's where I am on the municipal needs piece of this. And I would entertain this board looking into the possibility of challenging the building permit with the Zoning Board of Appeals. We are not the Zoning Board of Appeals, and we know that, but, you know, I think everyone has to understand that, you know, if you think about the federal government, there's the executive branch, there's the legislative branch, and there's the judicial branch. The judicial branch in Hopkinton is the ZBA. We are not the judicial branch. We are the CEO. We are the executive branch of the town of Hopkinton government. So, you know, the President of the United States is in court in the Supreme Court on a routine basis for different things. I don't think it's unusual for this executive body to go before our judicial branch, given the concerns we have for the community in general. And so I would certainly entertain supporting that type of effort.
Mr. Testari.
you know, I think that you could pretty much ask anybody in town, including all the members who are at the table right now, all the members of the board, if CVS would be their first choice of businesses to go into that lot. And I think that pretty much unanimously people would say, no, it's not their first choice. It's not my first choice.
No.
And so I guess as we go through this, you know, I'll restate something that I said at the last meeting. While I would rather see another business, I think that one of the primary jobs of this board is to work with the owners within the law. Mr. Herr made some points, and I know that Mr. Moe was not able to be at the meeting tonight. He was making the point strongly at the last meeting. And I think, again, we all agree that we do have some things that we would like to accomplish during this
period of transition of the property and the business. And one of the primary things for the good of all the businesses downtown and also for the comfort of the residents, both downtown and outside of the downtown area, is straightening the intersection, trying to find more parking places for the businesses that are in town, and things of that nature. I don't think that if your legal standing is weak, I don't think that the best approach to get those things from the new property owner is to kick them in the shins. I think that all that said, as far as taking things through the Zoning Board of Appeals, I think that having some party, whether it's this board or whether it's your organization, create the appeal and start the appeals process, it gets another set of ears out there and more people thinking about this. As it's been mentioned, we can't make the decision on whether or not to uphold an appeal. That's the ZBA's decision. I will say that with the evidence that's been presented, I shouldn't say evidence, but with the information that's been presented by town council, it would be very difficult for me to vote for the town to spend money on one set of attorneys to argue against another set of attorneys that are also being paid out of the other pocket. You know, but again, the ZBA, to go to the ZBA, it may be best if you have a lawyer, if you're trying to push for some particular outcome. But for the ZBA to listen to the argument doesn't require a lawyer.
Good. So, go ahead.
So, I think another reason, though, to support going to the ZBA is the ZBA is the judicial, you know, zoning body in town and across the Commonwealth in all the towns. But it also can be a facilitator to resolve the zoning questions and issues around the bylaws, and can also be the facilitator to put conditions into their decision, whatever that may be, that could facilitate or could accomplish some of the things that we're describing in terms of the municipal uses needed. So while we can, in a process, make sure that the community, through its judicial body, agrees with the use question, we can also make sure the community, through a conditions process, make sure that a reasonable deal is struck, if you will, to Mr. Catino's point about how we negotiate with an incoming business to the center of town. By filing an appeal to go to the board of the Zoning Board of Appeals, we're doing just that. We're not saying, someone's going to lose their job over this. We're not saying that we're going to start yanking licenses and do all kinds of other stuff. We're saying we want to make sure we understand this whole process, and we want to make sure that we get what we can get for the community as a whole and address as many concerns as we can, through the process that's outlined by law. That's why I'd encourage the board to consider this approach.
Are you good, or do you have anything? Okay. So normally I just try to manage the process and let everyone else have the say, but I guess my words here would be, I want to do one thing. First of all, for those who don't know, Mr. Mosier has taken ill, and he'll be fine, but he's actually at the hospital tonight getting antibiotics, so that's why he couldn't make it. He's got a very valid excuse. He did, however, send me an email, and so I just want to relay his comments first on to just give him his due. And here they are in summary. So with regard to CVS, here are the comments of John Mosier. Three things. First of all, I think we've already covered this. He said they've not come into town as a business looking to be a good neighbor should. So I think we can stipulate we all agree with that. Second of all, and this is the part that we've all been wrestling with, they're subject to and protected by our state and local laws, whether we agree with their business philosophy or not. And this goes to questions of due process and fair treatment for all, whether or not we like them. I mean, this board is, by and large, well, fundamentally at its core, required to follow all the laws. And so we really have to be meticulous, and it has nothing to do with what we think of anybody or anything. Everybody gets a fair hearing in front of us always. And the third thing is we should ensure that we're enforcing our zoning and related bylaws correctly, which I think is the point you were going towards. With regard to community interests, I think we've covered this as well, but Mr. Mosier made a couple points. He thinks critical components for the community going forward here would be fixing the intersection, which we've talked about, providing some municipal parking spaces, so this would be a pathway for us to solve some of the parking problems downtown, and then also have some kind of a gathering place that can be used by the community. So there's Mr. Mosier's comments on this whole topic, which I think dovetail with what we've already said. So coming now to my thoughts, I'd be fine with going to the ZBA for all the reasons you said. The only thing I'm concerned about is I don't know that we have an argument. The building inspector had a very clear statement about why. The town council has reviewed this, and without trying to tip this one way or another, he's given us his opinion that what he did was proper and fitting with the bylaws. So I'm torn because I like everything you said, and I'd be willing to pursue it. I'm not convinced that we have any argument to make, and so then I worry about the expense and the risk profile of getting into it with a developer if we don't have a leg to stand on. So that's the only part that I hang up on.
Do we have to make that determination tonight whether we actually do this or not?
Well, we're kind of going to run out of time.
The appeal can be filed, and then can people join the appeal as it moves forward? Can entities join the appeal as it moves forward?
Town council question.
Well, I don't know exactly what you mean by join the appeal, but usually in hearings of this type, members of the public are allowed to come and participate.
I think the question was, Mr. Mayor, is if somebody else filed the appeal, could the board? So my concern again is the strength of the argument here, because I'm far from having any confidence that we have any kind of a reasonable argument. And so again, I I worry about the risk and the expense of the thing. So I think where Mr. Herr was going was if an appeal had been filed, could the board decide to file it and not have to decide tonight about whether or not it supported it? And that's what he meant by joining. He meant that there's an appeal already in front of the ZBA. Can the board decide to join it later?
And support.
Support
that by taking the actions we would need.
I think the answer is technically no, but practically the answer is yes, which is to say if someone were to file an appeal, the Board of Selectmen could appear at that hearing and present its views.
Mm-hmm.
It wouldn't, strictly speaking, be the appellant, but it certainly would be entitled to be heard with regard to its views. If the ZBA renders a decision, that decision is appealable by anybody who's aggrieved by it, whether or not they were the appellant in the first place. So I think the answer is, as a legal matter. Only somebody who files can actually be the appellant.
Right.
You don't lose many rights by not being the appellant if you choose to exercise them.
And how confident are you in your – so I don't want to put words in your mouth, having already scolded somebody for that. What do you think about – can you? And I know you've put in a memo and you've talked about it, but let's just rehash it one more time. What do you think about the counterarguments to the validity of the issuance of the building permit? As stated by those folks, and how confident are you, whether because of their questions or others, that your conclusion is whatever airtight, really solid? I mean, how much opportunity do you think there is for that decision to be reversed by ZBA?
Very small possibility.
Okay.
I don't consider this to be a close case at all.
By no means. And that's because they just fit cleanly within the zoning bylaw?
We have to. It's pretty difficult to make the case that this is not a retail store. It's right. Common parlance. That is what it is. And everything else feels like a post hoc justification for coming up with a different view. And as I said last time, I'd hate to be the one who has to stand up in front of a judge and say, this is not a retail store.
Mr. Chair.
And the pharmacy part doesn't change that at all, right? The fact that it's going to have a pharmacy attached doesn't?
We have a number of places in the zoning bylaw where we reference retail stores that sell medications, so it's pretty hard to say that that because this is a pharmacy, it's different.
See, this is where I hang out. I can't figure out the route. But what are you going
to
say?
Right, but that's why I'm asking about whether we have to make this decision tonight or not. I mean, we're missing one of our members.
Right.
You know, to formulate an argument to debate whether or not we would want to put forward in support of an appellate or individual before the Zoning Board of Appeals or not, I don't think we have to make that decision tonight because I don't think we're quite ready for our vote on what we're going to stand up and say through an attorney that we hire.
So let's talk about the pathway to
I'm
get
just talking about the. I'm just trying to figure out if there's a process, it's a reasonable process, and one of the questions I have is, through the chair to town council, if we were to pursue this and we decide to vote to make an argument before the Zoning Board of Appeals in support of the appellate, is that the correct term? Can CVS, if that fails, is there any risk for us in this? It seems like a reasonable thing to do. One step of appeal is not like unheard of in American business today. Are we putting the town at risk if we join the appellate?
Well, everything that you do has some risk. If you're talking about...
So I've learned, yes.
If you're talking about, are you exposing the town to legal liability for damages, the answer is probably not.
Right. So what's the harm?
If part of your ultimate goal is to... get some relief for the intersection there. Working with a landowner who isn't hostile is probably something that will make life a little easier for you. So as a practical matter, there might be some risks associated with antagonizing the landlord. But
I think we've antagonized him plenty so far, so I'm not worried about that. Yeah. I think. I'm just trying to ascertain the level of risk that we would put ourselves at. I mean, we're talking about fully vetting a question that has a lot of people wondering in town at the moment. And to go to the ZBA and put forth an argument to fully vet a question, like we fully vet ad nauseum questions at town meeting. I know we're trying to get people to show up at town meeting, but sometimes it can go on and on and on. You know, we haven't done that with this issue in a public forum. We're doing it on front lawns, and we're doing it here on a couple of nights, but we're not fully vetting the issue in a fair process, in my view.
That's
so
why I'm advocating.
Yeah, so let's, but again, I think the question for me is we have to have a valid argument. And I've not yet heard, you know, or had Ray opine that any of the arguments we've heard are going to do anything. So why am I doing this if there's no pathway? So I would need for us to do this. I personally would need for us to have something that was defensible. And Ray made it quite clear that everything we've heard so far is not defensible. So this is going to take getting something else. And now what I don't know is how to get that. But I do know that we've got a lot, and none of it has passed your test. I know everyone's got their hands up. I'm ignoring you on purpose. So I will come to you, but I want to finish the board up first. I'm not trying to jailhouse lawyer this with a bunch of sort of, right, I want to get the lawyer answer. So how would we go about determining if we had an argument?
I personally think we need time set aside to have a discussion and a debate about whether we think there's merits to the arguments and whether we want to put those forward or not. If we can't come with a resolution that we feel there is,
yeah, but at the end of the day, we're going to need a lawyer to tell us that the arguments hold water, and our lawyer so far has told us none of the arguments hold water. And it isn't like we've said. I mean, so this is the rub in the whole thing for me.
I understand what you're saying.
Can I make a suggestion to the board?
Just hold on one second. I've turned to my right and totally cut you guys out. So, any comments, thoughts, further?
I
will come to you. I'm not ignoring you. I just want to get these folks back in.
The group absolutely has to file an appeal. To Brian's point, to if anything, just to give us the pause, because I really want to sit down and talk to these guys. I really want to make sure that we get the land for this intersection. And I want to make sure that, to Mr. Sestari's point, that this board's not the ones kicking them in the shins under the table whilst on the top of the table saying we want a good deal for the land. So we have to walk, I believe we still do have to walk a fine line because we may spend, oh shoot.
Sorry, I didn't have my microphone on. We may spend money on both sides. We're gonna be spending money on the two sides of the lawyers, plus we're gonna be, the price of the land might keep going up and up. But the appeal, we need that pause. We absolutely need a pause.
Okay. We are way, way over time. Here's all I'm going to listen to is specific yes. ideas for the board on how to get a good argument going. No generalized commentary, please. So go ahead.
There's an attorney that appeared before the Zoning Board of Appeals last week who's seen some of the information that the committee's put together. His billing rate is $300 an hour. He estimates it would take about 8 to 10 hours to represent this case for the committee before the board. So I would respectfully ask is you could contact this person, discuss it with him. My guess is within a couple of hours he could probably give you sufficient information to make a case. You don't need to file it officially until you feel comfortable with it. So for less than $3,000 you could contact someone who's already appeared before our ZBA, get information from them to make you feel comfortable one way or another to continue and bring this matter forth. And I think the amount of investment would be less than $3,000.
Okay, it's one. Sandy, real quick.
This is just real fast. I don't see why we need attorneys and you need to fight this at first. Why don't you just file an appeal and ask for a ruling? Have the ZBA look, is this a retail or is this a health facility? Retail fits, health facility doesn't. Before we get into the attorneys and we look at taking it beyond this step, why don't you just ask for a clarification of what it is, challenge Chuck Cadillac's decision and just take that next step forward.
Okay. Thank you for that. Is that a pathway? Do we have to have an argument or can we just file an appeal?
Then you got to go to land court.
I mean, what are you going to do with it? All right. Go ahead.
I don't understand the concept of filing an appeal and not making an argument. The ZBA, if you file an appeal and you're not and you don't present an argument, I don't understand how the ZBA is supposed to come out and any different from what the building inspector has done. Nobody's made any argument that they can base it on.
Okay.
So I guess what I'm hearing is that the ZBA is just going to use the information that's presented to them from the appellate, and you know, and the information that they also get from town council, and they're going to weigh it and make a decision right. Based on that.
So this becomes more of a feel-good exercise, honestly, than a practical.
That's what it sounds like. To
transitional
exercise.
Quick
sentence.
Yes, sorry. Please.
What? You guys have a really good argument. Your letter is well done. I don't know how a lawyer could do a better job than this. Yeah, you guys, you know what I mean? No, I'm to the ZBA. No, I'm just saying that, you know, reading your letter, it looks not no.
Oh, okay.
Looks as good as raised.
Help us move this forward. So okay. What is it you do? You
no,
do
I think that I don't see, you know, the I don't.
So your concept is they should just file the appeal.
Right. I think they have the great. I think it's
Mr. Chair.
Strong.
I think yes.
May I suggest that we table this discussion to our next meeting? Encourage those frustrated or concerned about the situation to do what it is they feel necessary to do in terms of filing an appeal, and then at some point we can visit at our next meeting, you know, what our position may be, if any, and go from there. Right. Because we're not going to file the appeal ourselves. The Board of Selectmen is not going to file that appeal, right? So if we're not going to do that, not that we've taken that vote, but it's fairly obvious. Then others can do whatever it is they feel necessary to do, and then if we decide at our next meeting to participate in a process, we can make that decision at that time when we've had more time to look at the issues and the facts.
I think that's the pathway. I think you all just should go file this appeal on your own, and then we can join in if we can figure this out. But I agree. I don't know. I think there's a strong enough feeling that we have a case to make.
I would just ask that we have this as an agenda item for our next meeting.
I think we're wrapped up, but you got a quick one?
Yeah. My name is Mary Sherini, 108 Davis Road, Harpington. I think a really good argument for this would be we really don't want any more drugs in Harpington. I think that's a big part of Harpington does not want to end up like Springfield, Worcester.
Thank you.
Well, I did hear CVS do, I don't know if this establishment, CVS, they are having a pharmacy, correct? That they actually sell needles? That's what I heard. Like, I mean, I don't buy them. But you know what I mean. Oh, my God, I should have said that.
So, okay.
But I think it's a really good argument. I mean, with all the kids in Hopkinton, it's a very small town, but there's a lot of kids in Hopkinton, and I think the farther away we keep them, I think better.
Okay.
That would help in the argument. Thank
okay.
you.
All right, so I'm going to hold it open. Anybody have a motion to make? Is there anyone who wants to make a motion? Going once, going twice? All right, hearing no motion, I think we're done with this conversation. I think y'all wrote this letter that he thinks is quite good. I'm not a planning board person, so I have no background in this, but I think your best bet is to go off and do that, and then we can talk about this more, and if we can figure out an argument we're comfortable with, we can get on board. But it doesn't do anybody any good for the town to just do this just to make everybody feel good if there's no pathway forward. That's what I'm bothered by. Okay? Thank you, everybody, for coming in. I appreciate it. Okay, moving on. Next item on the agenda is Lake Massaponac appointments and action item. The board will consider appointing members to the Lake Massaponac Weed Control Advisory Group. We have several applicants for the Lake Massaponac Weed Control Board. So this was set up by the board the last time. It's got five members, including, I think, Mr. Kamala, two at-large members, am I mistaken? And I think that's the folks who have come forward for tonight, correct? So do we have in the room either the applicants? Well, I know one's not here, but I'll talk about him in a second. Cynthia Estimer, are you here? Cynthia, can you come up, introduce yourself, and talk about why you'd like to be in this committee?
I'm Cynthia Estimer. I live at 118 Hayward Street on the swamp side of the lake. I'm interested in serving on the advisory committee as someone who's lived down by the lake for 29 years. I've certainly seen the changes in the lake and would love to be able to do something that would be proactive. I'd like to work on the educational aspect of slowing down nutrients and stormwater runoff and things going into the lake that we don't want, and to figure out with all the good work that the Lake Maspinock Association has done thus far. I'm a member and have been for the almost 30 years. They've done a lot of great work, and I think that it's critical to bring in the elements of the DPW. Certainly CONCOM has weighed in at this point, and I'd love to have that connection with Parks and Rec. I think we could get some good work done, and I am thrilled that it would involve different boards of the town. But I am not someone who has a background in a professional background in weeds. But I can say that by hand-pulling, the residents have succeeded in nullifying the loosestrife invasion. So hard work can be a help. Any questions?
No, yeah. So, Mr. Harvey, you.
Thank you for stepping forward and helping with this. Do you have a strong opinion for or against the discussion we had earlier in the year about the weed control plan that was proposed at that time?
I'm glad you ask. I have come forward to be on this advisory committee because I do not. I have friends who are very much on one side or the other, and it's been difficult to listen and to it's important to listen, but my jury is still out. I would like to continue to do more homework. I've read more stuff on weeds and weed management, and I know I have volumes and volumes more to do. So, no, and I would like to keep some open minds so
thank
it's
you.
Not a one issue.
So.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Sestari.
Cynthia, no, thank you very much for coming out. I'm glad to hear that that you're still in the undecided camp. I have a feeling that when we're finished putting people on this committee, I'm sure we'll have one person on one side, one person on the other, and that's fine, as long as they have an open mind too. And I think that when we first started hearing about this situation, I think that I'll include myself with a few other people who were on the board. We kind of came down on one side, and as we started reading more about this, reading more about that, we kind of came to the middle, But that doesn't matter at this point. What we're looking for is a group that can really dive into this and get a lot of information. And for this initial phase, I guess basically the mandate has been, no pesticides. So that's the path that will be explored for this phase. But good to have you come out, and thank you very much is the bottom line.
John. Yeah. Thank you for sticking with this. I'm just surprised that the whole group was for CVS when this was such a huge meeting, a couple months ago. And then at town meeting, it took up, 40 minutes? And now we've got some paid employees here for this. Yeah. and so really thank you for keeping this keeping the forefront in your own in your head and heart, because we've got to do something about it, and it's disappointing that we've got to go through this process to get everybody on board and happy with it. But thank you so much for coming forward and continuing.
Cynthia, thank you as well. No, I read your background. I liked your discussion, so it's terrific. Thank you. All right, so we also have two other applicants, actually. The next one being Jamie Gonsalves. Jamie, not here tonight. Okay.
Sorry, who was that?
Jamie Gonsalves.
Oh, yeah.
Jamie. So, over in Downey Street. BS from UMass. Done consulting. DEP in Massachusetts. And then the third applicant, who I know won't be here tonight, is Drew Logan, who lives on Lakeshore Drive. Drew's been in front of the board before on this issue. He's the vice president of the Lake Maspinock Preservation Association. He's an abutter to the lake, and he's been heavily involved in the weed control effort, I know, to date. And I think, in fact, spoke in favor regarding this issue at town meeting, if I'm not mistaken. So I think he's known to the board. So, Ms. Kamala, we have three folks, if I'm not mistaken, two slots to appoint tonight. Is there a way to put a third on in some other role, or?
I'd love to vote all three, that's why.
That's what I'm trying to figure out.
Two at large, one makers.
One what?
Good, perfect.
Okay, good. Exactly. All right, so we have lake resident. Did we define that as actually on the lake, or is that just in the neighborhood of the lake? Are you on the lake?
On the swamp, but yes.
On the swamp.
Okay.
On the former lake. All right. So Cynthia's on the former lake. Drew's on the lake, apparently. Okay.
Yes.
So we can get, I'm sorry.
Jamie's up the street about a quarter mile.
Yeah, but he's not on the lake. Right. No. Okay. All right, so good. So the question for the board is, we have two at large and one lake resident to appoint. Yes, sir.
And who are the other two?
Drew Logan. Oh, the other two appointees that come. One come, well, go ahead. I actually don't remember right now.
Representative appointed by
Parks and Rec.
Commission.
Yeah.
And Park and Rec Commission.
That's it. I can remember the other one.
Okay.
So they, but we appoint, they recommend folks.
They recommend board appoints.
So it's a five-member board. Parks and Rec, CONCOM have to send people to us, which they haven't yet. And then we have two at large and one lakeside. Okay. So so three candidates, three positions. Any discussion? Mr. Sestari.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, I'd just like to say that, there's the five, there are the two appointed spots, and then the other three. My preference would be, of the three appointed spots, to at least have one person that is not immediately in the lakefront area. However, given that we have three candidates, and I think that it will probably be difficult to find somebody who's not on the lake, who's I don't want to say interested enough, but who will devote the time and the energy to this. I'm certainly willing to go with all three here.
Okay.
I don't see anything bad about any of them, but just the overall profile that I was looking for.
I think they're all known in the community. Mr. Catino.
I concur.
And Mr. Herr.
Having met Cynthia and heard her positions tonight, I know the other two applicants well, and I would support the appointment of all three.
Okay. So, Chair, I'll entertain a motion.
I'll make a motion that we...
Let's specify whether it's at large or lakefront.
Right. Okay. That we specify that Cynthia as the lakefront, and the two at-large members being Drew and Jamie okay. Gonzalez.
So we have a motion, rubbing it in for Cynthia.
Second.
Okay, so motion and a second. Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Present not voting. That's unanimous. Thank you so much for stepping forward and welcome to the committee.
Thank you.
So I don't know that you will organize until we have the other two folks. Cynthia, so I don't know that there'll be any organization until we make the other appointees. So I think we'll be in touch, right, is the answer on this? Okay. And we'll let
John. Yes.
We'll let Joe and Jamie know as well. Okay, good. Thank you all for that. All right, moving right along. Item 6 on the agenda is fiscal year 2015 performance evaluation reviews. I'm going to exercise chair's discretion and pull this off the agenda because I'd like to let all the members be present for that. And I know for a fact that Mr. Mosier hasn't had a chance to review the documents because of his illness, so we're going to push that till August. Town manager and fire chief have both been made aware of that, and they're okay with it. Which brings us to the next topic, charter review process, a discussion item. Per the town charter, section 7.7-6, the town is approaching the 10-year periodic charter review. The board will have a discussion on outlining a process for a charter review. So real quick for folks, town passed a charter in 2000, six, I guess it was actually. It calls for a review every decade on years ending in six. And there's actually a specific process that was outlined in the charter for how this should be done. It basically consists of appointing a committee. The town, by the way, it's not a board decision. It's the town clerk appoints a committee that then reviews the charter and makes any recommendations to town meeting, I guess, in the following town meeting, right? So it would be up this spring, potentially? Would it be as soon as next May's town meeting, Mr. Kamala? In terms of them making recommendations to town meeting, would it be at the May 2016 town meeting?
Yes.
Yeah, so they need to get cracking. Committee is seven members, will be appointed as follows. The Board of Selectmen, School Committee, and Town Clerk can each designate one person. The Appropriations Committee can designate two, and the moderator also gets to appoint two. So it's actually not a huge amount of discretion in this. So, Mr. Kamala, any comments to make here or things to add?
Yeah, a couple points. I think, as the chair mentioned, the process is already laid out in the town charter. I think what we're looking for tonight, which is the second point, is perhaps an endorsement from the Board of Selectmen that this process commence.
Okay. So real simple ask here, it's just to get this thing underway so we can get the committee in place, so they can get started, I guess as soon as possible, really, to get their meetings and be able to go to town meeting in 2016. Mr. Herr, any questions, comments?
Just ask the other appointing boards to consider their selection and act on it, yes, right?
Exactly. Mr. Catino.
Yeah, this is it's an important process because we've in the last 10 years we've noticed some good things about the charter and some things that could use some improving. So to put a group of people in there to tweak it can only make it better.
And Mr. Sestari.
Yeah, I agree. You know, this is it's a learning process, and even at 300 years old, we need to continue to learn. And this is something where we can try to tweak the document, you know, again, making things so that possibly we'll find areas where it will breed more inclusion among people, get a broader set of ideas as decisions are being made. And one thing I would like clarified is an interpretation on the appointments from various committees. Is it assumed that the appointments are from within the committee, or are the boards able to make appointments of people who are not on their committee?
The charter doesn't say, which means it's open. Jerry, I'm sorry, I should have probably gone to you to start. So welcome, and please, would you like to add anything?
I have the charter in front of me. Do you have that in front?
We do. We have the page, at least.
Microphone down. The microphone, just tilt it down towards you. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I can hear you now.
Thank you. I have the charter in front of me. Do you have that in front of you at all?
We have the page.
Hmm? Yeah? Okay. So from what I can see is that the board appoints one school. Let me see. The school committee appoints one, the town clerk. We're designated to appoint one person each. Appropriation, two, and two persons shall be appointed by the town moderator. So, and then we can make timeline and recommendations. I have made a book of those who have making some recommendations. So I'm following through on that, and maybe we can go over that at some point. Okay. Some residents have some concerns with. So.
Okay. Good. Great. Anything else, Jerry? Anything else?
No, nothing else.
So, Mr. Kamala, do you just want? Is this more of an information for the board? Or you want us to vote to follow the charter and get the
process? Order.
Yeah, I think it may be appropriate for the board to state formally its endorsement for the process too.
So, Chair, I'll entertain a motion for the board to endorse the town manager starting to work with the town clerk to get the charter review process underway.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion?
I'd just like to ask what the next step is. Is the next step in the hands of the town clerk for her to reach out to the boards? because the town clerk initiates the process.
Well, I think they should coordinate on this and have a conversation, and then I think what we might want to do is get each of the appointing bodies together to sort of talk about ground rules and such, because you're right. I mean, that could all be under the town clerk's jurisdiction. So, but that would be my suggestion about how we go about this.
That's fine. I'm more than willing to meet with the town manager.
Yeah. It's just because, for us all to coordinate. Does that work for you?
Yeah.
Okay.
I just wanted to make sure everything was clear, who was going to do what.
So we have a motion and a second. Do we have any further discussion? All right, all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye, opposed, present, not voting. That passes unanimously. Thank you so much, Jerry.
Thanks, Jerry.
Okay, next topic, number 8 in the agenda, fire chief hiring process discussion item. The board will begin discussing the process for hiring a new fire chief to replace Chief Clark, who is retiring in January of 2016. Mr. Camallo has a memo for us.
Thank you. I'm passing this down.
There it is. All right, so Mr. Camallo, having just gone through the police chief not that long ago, I think the process, in my opinion, that was a pretty good process. So maybe we can talk about, without having to walk through this extensively, the extent to which this is similar to or altered from the police chief hiring process and maybe some key decisions you want the board to make?
Yes, through the chair. First off, I should also acknowledge the support that I've received from the HR office in formulating the draft that I just shared with the board for tonight's review. Yeah, clearly, the process we're suggesting is similar to the process that was followed in hiring Chief Lee, the police chief. The key decision points being as follows, board directing whether we use local resources or a regional or national executive search firm. Also deciding whether the search will be limited to internal or regional or national catchment area. Thirdly, also thinking about what happens in the transition period, given the fact that we are now in July and Chief Clark has advised the town that he will be retiring in January of 2016. As we learned when we were going through the police chief's hiring process, our community involvement is very significant, it's very important, and I think to that point the Board of Selectmen did utilize the personnel committee in that regard. We also relied heavily on using the media to keep the public engaged and informed throughout the process. And then finally, the board will also need to start thinking about when the chief, the next fire chief is hired, what would be the onboarding process. So in summary, I think those are the key decision points. I've also, working jointly with the HR director, identified a framework that the board could utilize in the discussions going forward.
Before I go to questions, just one factual question. How long did it take to hire the police chief? Was that 6 months, do we think? Was that about what it took?
It was longer than 6 months.
It
was longer than 6 months.
Yeah. All right. So the point is we need to get cracking if we want to get this done by the end of the year. Starting off with Mr. Catino. Let's talk about decisions we need to make and whether you like the framework or not.
Yeah, considering that it's been vetted most recently, I'm thinking a national search maybe, but definitely a regional, because we definitely want the best person that's out there that may be looking. I don't want to limit us to just locally. That's my first question was, is you know, 5.5 months too few to find somebody? But hey, whatever it takes. We did a great job before. You guys did a great job before, and so I'm not concerned.
Okay, Mr. Sestari.
I think that the process we used for the police chief worked very well, we should continue to use that. Personally, the night that we hired the police chief,
probably ranks in the top five, if not top three nights, you know, as being on the Board of Selectmen and feeling like we did something really positive for the town. You know, I think that we made a great hire there, and it was, you know, due to a lot of the hard work on the hiring committee. You know, I think that we should be looking at candidates as far and wide as we can, and you know, that group will you know, cull the herd and bring us the best of the best. One thing that I'll just throw out there, and I haven't put a lot of thought into this because I didn't realize until the other night that this was going to be on here, but in the past, I know that I've thought about and had some very, very informal discussions with people about the structure of our public safety departments, and, you know, do we want to continue with police chief, fire chief, and, you know, our town manager, or over on the public safety side, do we want to have something more around, you know, a public safety, you know, I hate using this word now, but a public safety czar who oversees all the public safety areas with the possibility of us looking into other solutions, say, around EMT work that might be more cost efficient than what we have implemented at this time. And then having somebody who has the experience and the chops to oversee all of those areas, and basically, you know, making a slight restructure of this. Again, there's not a lot of thought or meat on the bone to talking about that tonight, but at least wanted to put it out there for people to think about and maybe make some conversation.
Okay. Over to you, Mr. Haar.
I think the process followed for the police chief was a good and thorough process. I think it was a very fair process, and it certainly invited and encouraged our internal candidates to step forward. And I'd certainly want to see that in this case as well as bringing in folks from the outside that have a different perspective and can add a different flavor to the discussions in the interview process. So I'm pretty comfortable with what we did before and what we could do here. I think it's a very interesting point Mr. Cesari raises about a public safety director for everything. I hadn't thought of it until now, or heard of it really till now. Interesting idea, bigger than what we're talking about here, though, right? Maybe a longer-term play, too. But we could certainly talk about moving in that direction at some point, maybe, you know, because these positions seem to go for about 3 to 5 years, and then people move on. So it would probably take us a year or two to figure that out, and then be ready for the next person to move on, and, you know, time.
And I don't think the current structure precludes us from moving in that direction, but it's just something I wanted to put out there for people.
Yeah, and a lot of that kind of discussion was held when we had the joint fire task force between Hopkinton and Ashland about sort of a, you know, the chief administrator was just that. He wasn't getting on a truck and going to fire. I mean, he was going to be in the office figuring it all out all the time. I'd be happy to have that conversation. But I think this plan's good.
So just to be clear, so we're not, is there any interest in the board in looking at a public safety director position instead of the fire chief? Because if it is, we should probably decide quickly, because that's, as we said, that's probably a year.
In lieu of going with a fire chief process?
I think you'd have to. Actually, that's not quite true. I guess the question is that something the board wants to talk about, or do we want to just do this and do what you said and start thinking about it way for the longer term?
I'm not sure if Mass General Law is going to allow that. We'd have to find that out. I think the police chief with the weapons and everything else, I think there's all kinds of different...
When we're looking for a police chief, look at see if we can, if some of these qualifications might be there, that chief administration person.
Well, then you're changing the job spec, so
you
just got to be careful.
That might not be a bad thing for us to start talking about, because, you know, when we're running into the EMT stuff, you know, when the EMT function of the fire department ends up being the major function of what they're doing, the primary job. Well, you know, do we, you know, is the, who we're calling a fire chief, is really a public safety officer, you know, already. And the fire is just a one almost smaller aspect of this this one small aspect of saving lives. And so, you know, maybe, you know, to sometimes be in the forefront is not a bad idea. You know, why do we have to sit back and say, okay, what's Ashland doing, what's Framingham doing, what's all these guys doing, what's Mass Law? Hey, let's start looking at it and be the trailblazers saying, look.
So I personally am completely fine with that, except it sort of leads us to a different decision tree, right? So the question then becomes, do we do the fire chief search regardless and see what happens while we think through the public safety concept, or do, which I think seems the safest route, if you will, and then, or do we what? Do we leave the job basically open and start looking at public safety? I mean, I guess I think that's an intriguing idea. I guess I I'd like to think it through. As I sit here, though, I'm very, very worried about the fact that we have 5.5 months, as you said, to get a new chief in place. What I care about mostly is I do not want to have I want to have a new chief hired by the end of the year, if it's humanly possible, to avoid the whole interim transitional part, which is just complicated no matter what you do. So I'm willing to think about this. I guess I'd like to do them concurrently as opposed to sequentially. Simply because the thing that matters to me most is having someone running that department on January 1st.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, first of all, I'd like to thank Mr. Catino for his support and you know, my seed. Not to vote no against my own motion, but I think that because of the timing, you know, we probably are best off in continuing or starting the fire chief search. I think that that does not preclude us from investigating another structure. While we're doing that, we probably have to also investigate the contract of our current police chief and also think about the structure of contract for the new fire chief so that everybody can, you know, live in a happy home.
That's going to be a complex move. Well, not really, because they don't work for him. They work for us.
Oh, okay.
So that's not a problem. Okay. So we'll take that as an intriguing teaser by Mr. Sestari and look into this, but sort of not do it now. All right, so I think what I'm hearing, Ms. Kamal, is I think we're pretty happy with the way we did things last time. And just to sort of rock down your list, I mean, we went more or less regionally, I think, last time. We definitely went outside, and I think the consensus of the board, speak up if no one agrees, is we should look inside, internally and externally again. I think that makes it a valid process, right? I think my personal, at least, strongly felt desire is to get this person on board, if at all possible, by January 1st, to avoid the interim issues. Again, the process we used last time was we had the personnel committee move this forward, really, in conjunction with you, and take it most of the way. I think they did a fabulous job. I think we all agree with that, so I would do that again. Community engagement, I think we did some of that last time. Again, it's just basically a cookie cutter from the last one. I can think personally of nothing I didn't like about the last process.
Yeah, I agree.
Except for the fact we ended up having to go with an interim chief for a fair bit of time. Does anybody have anything they want to change, quite honestly? So not hearing any takers, Mr. Kamal, I think we should just execute. I think the key part is, though, we got to execute. This has really got to kick into gear quickly. And what I'd like to do is in August, I'd like to have an update that actually has a fair amount of progress attached to it. So we got to find a way to make this an imperative for somebody to really get going. Because we have to start vetting candidates in September because they have to get through, extricate themselves from wherever they are, right? And so this all has to work.
Do we need to appoint a liaison to that committee or a member of that committee?
We did last time. It was Mr. Mosier. Should we pick that up next month when we have the full board on board? I don't think it's going to fall apart if we don't have anybody involved.
I think it's important that we clarify and make clear to this group, the personnel committee, Mr. Kamal, others, we really would like to have a person hired January 1st, 2016. Amen. I think sometimes we can go into these things a little bit open-ended, but if we set a clear objective, I think that'll help.
fortunately, through the chair, the HR director is here just now.
Okay. Right. So can we get the thumb screws on her and get this kicked into gear quickly?
Yeah, that point is well taken.
Okay. I'd like to see in August a timeline, and I'd like to see in every board meeting, at least once a month, till we hire this person, a timeline, achievements, and statistics, right? I really, we got to make this a big focus. This is a huge hire for the town. Especially because, let's not forget, we're talking about an emergency management director too, really, right? It's not just putting out fires. It's all the other things that he did for so long that we have to transition. Okay, so good. Any other comments, any other requests? I don't think you need a motion, Mr. Kamala, but tell me if you do. I think you kind of get it, and Maria, I know, gets it. Okay. All right, so moving along to item 10 on the agenda, position analysis and pay classification plans and action item. The board will discuss the proposed position analysis and pay classification plan. This has been hanging out there for a while for the board. I'd like to see if we can bring it on home. In general terms, what this has been a discussion is the town currently has pay scales that are set essentially in a vacuum, really. We don't have a consistent set of comparables we measure ourselves against. We don't have a lot of structure in place regarding how people are paid and how their pay is adjusted. And the goal of the town is to do several things, one of which is to attract the best people we can bring in. The second is to pay them fairly. And the third is to have a fair level of consistency in the process. And so what Mr. Kamala has done for several months now, and the board's gone back and forth about this, is work on the structure of a pay classification plan that would put employees into categories based upon their jobs, that would develop a consistent set of comparables to measure them against, and would ensure that the town, again, can attract the people it wants at the pay levels that are reasonable, and reward them appropriately for merit, which I think is the key point here. We're trying to get out of just time and grade payments to people. We want to reward our top performers and encourage those who aren't to perform better. So on that note, Mr. Kamala, there's a number of documents you've shared with the board over time. Do you have anything you want to add to this or correct?
Nothing except, again, to emphasize that the documents shared with you include the proposed pay classification plan, as well as the report that documents how we arrived at the plan that's been proposed tonight, and that overall,
I think working with the team here at Town Hall, what this represents for me is another step in a comprehensive process that we have had in place for years here at Town Hall, where we have looked at reviewing our job assignments and alignment of departments, and then moving on to institute a pay for performance system for non-union employees. We've also been discussing that concept with unions in town. And then thirdly, also making sure that we have a system for holding ourselves here at Town Hall accountable, looking for opportunities for continuous improvement. And again, this is another step which is part of a larger program that we've had in place for a while.
Okay. Mr. Herr, questions, comments, things you'd like to change?
So this has been going on for a while, and I think it's best that I defer to you folks on this one. I'm okay.
Okay. Over to Mr. Sestari.
I don't have any questions.
All right. And Mr. Catino.
I don't have that. I just appreciate all the hard work that Mr. Kahn has put into this. We brought it up at several executive sessions before.
I think it's. I did a great job, and thank you.
Okay, well, hearing vigorous endorsement of the plan, the chair will entertain a motion to approve the position analysis and pay classification plan.
So moved. Second.
We have a motion, a second. Do we have any further discussion? Okay, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Present not voting. That passes unanimously. Right. Let's put that into place, Mr. Kamal, and let's... having just done that, there is one thing I want to talk about with the board. Some of these pay analyses, I think, could potentially reflect substantial increases. And I think my concern with that when I went through the spreadsheet was that we not just have... sort of reflexively provide people already in existing positions with enormous increases in salary that may or may not be justified. So the only thing I would ask is, and it's fine to do this separately, I'd like to talk about whether people are comfortable with just leaving at the town manager's discretion, or whether we'd like to ask him if he proposes to make any kind of adjustment exceeding some threshold to at least have a conversation with the board beforehand. To ensure that we're doing this in the manner it was intended, which is to reward people who are filling the job fully with pay that reflects that their role they take. So, does anybody have any comments about that? I mean, again, I think there's a couple of choices: either the soft rule, town manager can decide; the hard rule, everything has to come to us; or the middle ground, which would be let's have some kind of limit above which we expect to have a conversation first. Any thoughts on that?
I think the middle ground is reasonable. As I say as a rule, but I trust Mr. Kamala's judgment in this, and in realizing how his decisions today on things like this affect different pain points as you move forward. But the board needs to be aware of these situations. And so I would rather be proactively aware as opposed to finding out retrospectively.
Okay, Mr. Hart, questions on that?
Sure.
And Mr.
And I think the middle of the road too, because so many times Mr. Kamalo has our back, and on some of these things, if there's any backlash, that we should have his back and look at some of the be in the middle ground for some of these.
So I guess I'd suggest just I don't know if we need to vote this or if we just want to give this a consensus. I mean, I think to extend Mr. Kamal, you plan to adjust anyone's salary by, 5%, 4%? What do you guys think? Something in that range.
I wouldn't put the number any less than 5.
Okay. So to the extent you wish you want to change some of the salary more than 5%, I think it would behoove you to have a discussion with the board first to talk about the rationale. And again, let's confirm that that person whose pay we're making a dramatic adjustment to fills the job specs as defined for that pay level, and then have a conversation about that. And I want to reiterate, the whole reason we have these pay levels is because we're going to have these criteria, and people are going to be expected to fill them. So again, this is a very clearly a pay for performance model we're putting in place. Is that good for you? Does that make sense without handicapping you sort of unnecessarily? I mean, what do you think?
I think it's a fair way of moving this forward. I think we've benefited immensely from continuously engaging the Board of Selectmen and at times also seeking input from the Personnel Committee on some of these issues. So I think it makes sense for us to make sure that we keep the board engaged.
Okay. All right. Okay. So anything more than 5%, let's plan to have those conversations with the person with all the detail we talked about.
Yep.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Kamala. All right, moving along. Item 11, liaison reports. Mr. Catino.
I don't have my notes. I'm sorry.
Down the luck. Mrs. Sestari.
excuse me. Parks and Rec had their grand opening of the Sandy Beach renovations, and I wasn't able to attend. I believe, was it Mr. Catino was there?
Actually, no, my family was there, but I wasn't.
Okay. But I heard that there was a huge turnout and very successful.
Okay. And Mr. Hart.
The MWRTA is opening their new transportation center this Friday. They have a grand opening ceremony, if you will, at 11 a.m. In Framingham. I will be traveling on business. I'm unable to attend, but it is this Friday at 11 if anyone's interested in going.
Let me turn my mic on here. That's all I have to report. Thank you.
Okay. Chair is nothing, and I didn't get anything from Mr. Mosier. Town Manager's Report, Mr. Camallo.
Yes. If it's okay with the chair and the board, there are two items that I can do.
If other people in attendance, that's item number four, Shimen China Sister City Relationship, as well as the land acquisitions. If that's okay with the board, could we take this out of order?
Of course. However you want to do it, Mr. Kamal.
Okay. I'll start with number three, the final action on land acquisitions approved the town meeting. I'm requesting the board review, discuss, and approve the land acquisitions that were approved at town meeting, subject to the town receiving a satisfactory appraisal on each of the properties, namely the Pratt Farm property, 102 Foot Street, Todaro Parcel, 147 Hayden Row, Evan property, 135 Hayden Row, and the Davis property, 15 Claflin Street. We have completed the appraisals. The board has reviewed them in executive session. I'm requesting that the board approve these acquisitions and also approve signing the documents that are part and parcel of moving this process forward.
Okay, so to recap, in executive session, the board was able to review the assessments and confirm that the town wanted the board, town meeting directed the board to have an assessment done on all the done on all the properties prior to purchase to confirm that the purchase price was justified by the appraisal. And I think I know, based upon the executive session discussion, in all cases, the appraisal was, at least to some extent, greater than the purchase price. So we're covered on that. We don't have any places where the purchase isn't justified. And we accepted those appraisals in executive session. So what you want the board to do now, Ms. Camallo, is determine if it wants to execute the purchase and sale agreement for each of these. Is that right?
Yes, that is correct.
Okay.
Mr. Chair.
Sorry. Doug, can I get you to go there? Because they can't hear you otherwise.
Yes, of course.
Yes. Can you start over again at the mic?
Sure. My name is Doug Resnick. I represent the Todaro family, one of the parcels that's being purchased. And prior to town meeting, we had executed purchase and sales agreements for this property, all the properties, at least for ours. And they were all contingent on all the things that needed to happen, town meeting approval by two-thirds, the ballot box, of course, debt exclusion, and appraisal. So we're sort of feeling like we're in position to, if the board sees fit, to go forward.
Thank you. I think we're just doing it. What's wrong? What am I missing?
Mr. Camallo just sort of indicated that it's time to sign the P&Ss. I'm just suggesting that we've already signed ours.
You're saying they're signed. Go ahead.
To be clear, that they are addendum to the P&S. Specifically,
excuse me,
addendum.
Addendum to the P&S.
There's an addendum?
Yes, specifically identifying the likely closing dates. We didn't have those dates at the time we did that.
Oh.
Okay.
Yeah. Does anybody have a copy of the addenda or addendum?
You should ask their lawyer. No. I'm kidding.
We have copies.
So you haven't seen it, Doug? I mean, I just want to make sure we're not going to have trouble there.
I haven't seen it. We sort of haven't seen things right along. We've been asking for them and getting things and cooperating.
So how do we do an addendum if he didn't see it?
Yeah, our assumption is that you've been working with Tom Harrington from Race Office. And we are sure that this documents were ready for prime time. So if you have reservations regarding yours, we can postpone this on the day.
I don't have any problem with the notion of an addendum per se. I just kind of like to see it before.
All right. So here's what we're going to do, Doug. We're going to vote to execute the addendum in that case, and the purchase and sales on the others. If obviously, if you don't like it, I mean, we're going to vote to execute the one that's been written, so if you don't like it, we'll just have to revisit it.
Mr. Chairman, can I just jump in here?
Yeah.
If you look at the motion that's town council, I believe, has prepared for us for this evening, it says that we're going to vote to move to pursuant blah, 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 to execute an amendment to the purchase order and sale agreement between the inhabitants of the town of Hopkinton and so on and so forth.
Yep.
So that amendment is the to account for the approval of the appraisal pursuant to the aforementioned annual town meeting warrant article. So you haven't seen the amendment yet because it doesn't exist. We're going to vote to exercise and put forth an amendment that you would then sign, and that would close the deal, as I read this motion.
And Jamie's just handed me a copy of the language, and we have absolutely no objection to that.
Okay.
Problem solved. Okay.
Just didn't get to see it.
Okay. So, does anyone on the board have questions? Yes, sir.
I have a motion I'd like to make.
I think that's an order. Go ahead.
I move that the board of selectmen vote pursuant to the unanimous vote on the
May 6, 2015, on Article 44 of the annual town meeting to accept the appraisal as presented by Stephen G. Elliott and to execute an amendment to the purchase and sale agreement between the inhabitants of the town of Hopkinton and Philip Todaro et al. For the purchase of the property located at 147 Hayden Row Street, Hopkinton, Massachusetts, to account for the approval of the appraisal pursuant to the aforementioned annual town meeting warrant article.
Okay, so we have a motion?
Second.
We have a second. Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Present not voting. That's unanimous.
Mr. Chairman, I move that the Board of Selectmen vote pursuant to the unanimous vote on May 6, 2015, on Article 43 of the annual town meeting to accept the appraisal as presented by Stephen G. Elliott and to execute an amendment to the purchase and sale agreement between the inhabitants of town of Hopkinton and Joseph F. Irvine and Sue Constanza for the purchase of the property located at 135 Hayden Row Street, Hopkinton, Massachusetts, to account for the change in the time for performance.
Here we have a motion.
Second.
And we have a second. Any further discussion? Doug, are you good with this one? Are you on that one, too?
No, Mr. Chairman.
That's not you. Oh, you don't care. Okay, fine. Okay, so we have a motion. We have a section. We have no further discussion. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Present not voting. That also passes unanimously.
Mr. Chairman, I move that the Board of Selectmen vote pursuant to the unanimous vote on May 6, 2015, on Article 47 of the annual town meeting to accept the appraisal as presented by Stephen G. Elliott and to execute the purchase and sale agreement between the inhabitants of the town of Hopkinton and Raymond L. and Kathleen T. Davis for the purchase of the property located at 15 Claflin Avenue, Hopkinton, Massachusetts, 01748.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion. We have a second. Any further discussion on this one? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Present not voting. That's unanimous.
Mr. Chairman, I move that the Board of Selectmen vote pursuant to the unanimous vote on May 6, 2015, on Article 48 of the annual town meeting to accept the appraisal as presented by Stephen G. Elliott and to execute an amendment to the purchase and sale agreement for 102 Fruit Street to account for the newly defined lots 2B and 2C, to adjust the time for performance, and account for the required approval of the appraisal on the property pursuant to the aforementioned annual town meeting warrant article.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion. We have a second. Further discussion. Again, I just want to point out to the board, we did have on this property in particular, I don't know if you did any others as well, an environmental impact study, right, that defined some things to be dealt with before we close. We have or will communicate that to the seller?
Yes, that has been communicated to Wayne Davis.
Okay.
And he did agree to take responsibility for removing the items that we identified.
And so that's a contingency to closing, right? So that'll be all dealt with before we close?
Yes.
Okay, I just want to be very sure the board doesn't purchase that property with that some of that stuff, the detritus left on it.
Yes, and also for the record, the phase one environmental reports for both the Irvine and Todaro were performed prior to town meeting.
So just, to be clear, Ms. Kamala, we're not, this P&S will not be executed until those cleanup items have been dealt with, right?
That is correct.
Okay, and is that somehow inherent in this motion? I just don't want to be forced to buy it without that stuff done.
Well, the P&S stipulated that prior.
That's why I'm like, sure, does the P&S actually stipulate that? Okay.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, good. Yeah. All right, so any other questions? We have a motion, we have a second, we have no further discussion. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Present not voting. That also passes unanimously. All right. Moving right along, Mr. Kamala. Yes, sir.
Just one thing.
course.
I think we had communicated a couple times with Norman and with the board about the timing of the closing. When we originally did sign the P&S, we had put in a not later than September 30th date, and we were hoping that the board would be able to, which the you all signed, which we're hoping you'd be able to observe.
Can we do that, Ms. Kamala? I mean, that seems inherently plausible to me.
Yes.
Thank you.
I think we'll, I mean, honestly, Steve, I think we'll try to beat that. So, I mean, let's...
Oh, if you beat it, that's great.
Okay.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Yeah. Mr. Kamala, back to you.
Yeah. Shimen China sister city relationship. Back last year in December, the board authorized Mr. Kilduff and the town manager to pursue creating a sister city relationship with Shimen China. And the goal then was to establish a global tri-party relationship between Hockington, Marathon Greece, Shimen China, with a goal of broadening the spirit and culture of marathons and increasing the bilateral or trilateral relationship between the three cities. Tonight, Mr. Kilduff is here to join me in updating the board on the progress made to that end.
Of course. You behaved yourself tonight, so. Thank you, sir.
Hello.
Hello. Mr. Kilduff, welcome.
Thank you. The two pieces of correspondence speak to Norman's introduction. You recall the presentation we made several months ago that Hockington was in a unique position to begin to be a part of an international network amongst communities. I want to reinforce that while the marathon may be the common platform, it's the connection with the communities that is going to, I think, bring great dividends. The document from Shimen China is written by people in the public affairs section of Shimen, which is about 10 million people, by the way. And you'll notice that they're talking about creating a relationship through a particular district in Shimen, which happens to be in the southern part of China. It is was one of the first powerful economic zones within China. It's a shipping hub and also a focal point for major 500 company U.S. Companies in China. The other correspondence is from the mayor's office in Greece, which acknowledges the discussions we've had and is encouraging all of us to move forward quickly. You did authorize us to go ahead and do this before. This is the form of an update. I can also tell you that discussions have now started through Marathon Greece with a community in Kenya. We're focusing there on the region from which the marathon champions come from, as opposed to Nairobi or a big city, for obvious reasons. Wilson Carrier, who was here last year, is a member of parliament and is very interested in helping us to push through that connection. And then we recently started work with economic development people in Toronto, Canada, to add them to this network. The mayor of Marathon, it's his hope that he will be here either this fall as an adjunct to attending the Marine Corps Marathon or next spring. And I will also just give you a little heads up. Next year is the 70th anniversary of Stelianos Kariakides' 1946 Boston Marathon win. And we recognize that win with the sculpture that's at mile one. So all of this is now starting to come together. How we take advantage of it is yet to be determined, but the stage is now set, the connections are made, and the network is starting to develop.
That's a great update. Thank you. I love it. Mr. Herr, over to you.
Great update. I think it's a great endeavor for the community to pursue. And I'm very excited to see how this all plays out, but anything I can do to help would be, I'm glad to do.
Consider running the Xiamen Marathon.
Right, go to China.
It's a long plane ride before you run a marathon.
Oh, how about Athens?
We can talk offline.
Okay, good.
I know. Mr. Sestari.
Thanks, Tim. You know, you pursue this tirelessly, and you know, brings a greater spotlight and profile to the town, which is always helpful. And you know, it's nice to know and feel like we have these connections around the world. And I'd love to
stop.
I'd love for us to have the opportunities individually, obviously, and to eventually visit and meet some of these folks, some of the leaders of the community and other folks in the area.
Okay.
And it's going to be the challenge, Mr. Chairman. The next point of discussion is how do we get all of you or some of you in total or in the various locations, how we work that out. So we need to at some point talk about that. That's critical.
Well, he's a time hopping than Jet.
one of my favorite things is when I'm in Europe or in Asia, when people say, where you're from, and I say, Hopkinton. I said, where's that? And I say, 26.2 miles outside of Boston. And it's just such a fun way to start a conversation because there are so many runners all over the world, and everybody knows the Boston Marathon. So thanks for opening up Hopkinton to the world, and looking forward to that marathon center. But we'll talk about that one. I'll put that on an agenda or something.
Tim, thanks for the update. It's always great to have you come
in.
I really appreciate
it.
Thank you,
Norman. Thank you. Thank
you, Tim. Thanks, sir. Next, Mr. Kamala.
Thanks to the wonderful and spectacular efforts by Jamie, Helen, Maria, Glenn in our office. Working with Rebecca Ann Gebler, who is a legal intern, who in fact is a Hopkinton resident, Hopkinton High School graduate. We are now the proud owners of a licensing authority manual. This is a document that outlines the permits and licenses issued by the Board of Selectmen. It's intended for both internal as well as public distribution. What the manual does is it specifically identifies the licenses issued, the application procedures in place for processing that license, and also the other requirements pertaining to how the town or the board actually processes the license. We thought it was very important to put all this information in one document, create a one-stop shop for all the Board of Selectmen licenses, and again, through the wonderful and spectacular efforts by Jamie and Maria, we do have this document now in the office. We'll be posting it on the web. It's available for the public. It's available also to the board for your review.
Thank you, Mr. Kamala. Anybody have any questions, comments, discussion on that? Moving right along, Ms. Kamala.
Okay. At this point, with the chair's permission, I'll ask that Chris Howell, Finance Director, join us at the table. We are both giving the board an update on the FY14 balance sheet as well as the FY15 budget closing process.
Okay. Do we have handouts for the board?
Yes. Let me start off by acknowledging that the process for closing FY14 presented some opportunities as well as challenges. The process, as it turned out, was not as smooth as we would have liked it to be. we were faced with the following challenges. One, staff transitions that really severely limited our internal capacity. Two, we were also dealing with the conversion and data migration from IFIPS to Munis. And finally, we also were relying, in fact, based on the first two reasons, on outside consultants whose focus as well as time was spread very thin. The consultants we work with work for numerous other towns. And it is against that background that I'm pleased to share with the board that with regard to FY14, the audit process by Bogarty, Harrison and Company is now complete, with finalization of the full audit report pending. In my memo, I have outlined very broadly for your convenience what we as a community benefit from an audit process. And thus, now that we have completed the FY14 audit process, our focus energy in the next 3 months are towards closing FY15. And based on our recent experience working with DOR, our intention is to make sure that going forward, we will ask the auditors to complete their audit process before we present our balance sheet to the state. I have noted in my memo to the board that there are challenges also at the state level. Namely, DOR has indicated to us that our field representative, as well as our supervisor, the director of accounts, retired as part of the statewide early retirement incentive program. Our understanding is that they will be back for 90 days beginning next month, and so we're hoping that we will be able to find Hockington Sport in their schedule and agenda within those 90 days. So again, the news here being, or the message here being, we did face challenges in closing FY14. The process did not go as smoothly as we would have liked. I'm happy to report that against that background, we have completed the closing FY14, completed also the audit process. We're now working on making sure that we close FY15 expeditiously and find our spot in the schedule at DOR to make sure that we certify FY15 very early in the process. Our schedule is, our plan is to get that done by early September. And Chris is here to walk the board through the details of the FY14 balance sheet and also illustrate to the board what information we have gathered relative to the town's free cash status for FY14.
Chris, thank you. Welcome. Can you, again, we don't. Typically the board doesn't go all that deeply into free cash calculations. I think what I'd like to understand would be, at least to get this started, would be what happened a little bit, maybe a little bit of, beyond anything Mr. Kamala said, if there's anything else to talk about that. And then talk about the number, the bottom line number. Talk about how much it's different compared to typical years, and then talk about why. So we don't need to hear every line item. We would never do that in typical fashion. So I just want to hear the number, the delta from what's average, and then the reason for why it's different.
Sure. Thank you. Thank you, Norman. The closing FY14, as Norman mentions, challenging. In addition to some of the issues that Norman highlighted, the transition to a capital projects fund, which was part of the implementation of the new software, that was an addition to the town's accounting, and that in itself created some of the challenges that led into what you referred to, the variance between the figure that I think was discussed, although never certified or published, and the figure that we've estimated for FY14. A large amount of that variance, essentially all of it, was due to an accounting transaction that was recorded correctly, but it was overlooked during the close of the year. And it led to a large variance that we've now identified as not being the case. The figure that we've estimated for free cash in FY14, you have in front of you, and you have the calculations, but the bottom line figure is about $2.4 million. In relation to prior years, that's a bit higher. It was 2.19, I believe. I don't have the figure exactly in front of me, but it was about 2.1, 2.2 in FY13. And it was in the $2 million range for the few years before that. It had been fairly low, and as low as about $300,000 going back 10 years or so. And before that, up as high as $2 million. So within the last few years, it's in range. And it's about in range as far as a percent of the budget that I would expect to come back as unexpended or available balances.
Okay. Questions from the board? Mr. Sestari.
So after certification, then do we need to have a special town meeting to accept the free cash?
Not to accept it, but to use it.
Or approve it? Or
Through the chair, only if there's a plan to appropriate from free cash. Right.
Okay. Yeah. Were there...
And also, in terms of certification, just to be clear, the FY14 numbers that are in front of you are our projected estimates. At this point, because we're beyond June 30th of this year, this number will not be certified. When we get to certifying FY15, we'll be starting from a zero balance. So I just want to make sure that we make...
This will be rolled into the 15 number, and rather than 2.4, we might end up with, I'm just going to say a number, 3.5 or 4 or 2.1 or something. Something else other than this.
Sure. In a sense, not to be too technical, in a sense, yes, the balance becomes the starting point for the calculation of the year that just ended. But in the accounting process, it goes back into the wash with all the other funds in fund balance. So not to be too technical, but essentially, yes.
Yeah, don't get too technical with me because I glaze over on this stuff. And so at this last town meeting, what were some of the allocations that we had made for free cash that we ended up funding in different ways? For approving funding in different ways, I should say.
In fact, for the most part, the capital articles and the other operational expenditures that we'd identified as items that could be funded through free cash did not move forward.
So that's all the problem.
And so, I guess what the board partially needs to think about is if we get to the point of having a special town meeting, if we also want to try to move those forward as well. I'm assuming that if we felt that they were articles that were important going into May, we still kind of are going to think that they're important now. My last question is, Chris mentioned that, back 10 years ago, our free cash was, around 300,000 plus or minus whatever, and now more as of late, it's been around 2 million or so. Why is that? To me, it seems, unless you tell me that revenues exceeded what our estimates were going into the fiscal year, it seems like when they're $300,000, maybe we were doing a more accurate job of budgeting. versus 2 million, it kind of seems to me, and again, I'm open to the fact that maybe our revenues are higher than what we thought, but it seems to me like we're getting this budget and we're basically taking in taxpayer dollars that we may not need this year, and we're rolling it into the next year.
It's new growth.
For me, it's a combination of several factors. I think first and foremost, I think the board should take credit for
expanding. Depend on us.
Yes, we appropriate money is a town meeting, but we only spend when we absolutely have to. I think I see that in my conversations with department heads. Secondly, the town has also been fortunate in the last years to receive unexpected revenues, and that has helped. And thirdly, I also want to believe that the process we are going through in terms of really looking at our type of accounts and seeing how we account for accounts does help now and also will help in the future.
Haven't we also had a lot of new growth that we don't budget for? I think a lot of it's new growth.
Yeah.
You know, legacy comes in and they're paying those huge chunks. Yeah. So that's probably an extra $1 million a year. I'm betting you that's $1 million a year right now, extra.
So a lot of the new growth, through the budgeting process, we identify it beforehand as an estimate.
But we tend to estimate low, though.
Yeah.
So on purpose.
And that's just what I was asking.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you,
Chris.
I would say this is not strictly a case of budgeted revenues and budgeted expenditures, but also funds remaining available from various transactions. The general fund is the repository for all town funds that it may need to either subsidize or receive additional balances from. That includes essentially any fund that's not allocated to an enterprise or a trust. So it's larger than strictly a budgetary calculation. It's really it's much closer to a calculation of just the basic accounting equation of assets minus liabilities equal equity. The owner's equity is undesignated fund balance that you see on your balance sheet. From there, that amount's reduced as certain funds are reserved for different purposes to reach free cash. So it's I hope this isn't okay. Well, it's not strictly a budgetary issue, though. That's the point that I was trying to make.
Good. Anything more, Todd? Mr. Herr.
I came into this kind of a town meeting, and so I missed some of the early discussions and concerns and things that came up, so I don't fully understand all that's going on to get us to this point. $2.4 million free cash on a $70 million budget is about 3%, not outrageous. I'd love to see it in that $300,000 to $500,000 range, because that's tight budgeting, it's tight forecasting, it's tight fiscal management, it's tight controls, it's not spending what we don't have to spend, all those things. But based on my limited knowledge of the last year or so and the financial situation with the balance sheet, I think we're in a good place at the moment. Thank you.
Mr. Catino.
Hey, I'm just glad to see us in the black and not the red, like most towns. So this is, it's, as Mr. Hurst said, I'd like to see it tighter, but if it's caused by growth, I'm not opposed.
Well, as Mr. Kamala said, they could make it tighter by spending more.
No.
Yeah, we don't want that.
No.
Okay, so the number is what the number is. I mean, my question comes down to, does this point out any skill sets downstairs we need to reinforce? I'm troubled by all the back and forth, all the changes along the way. And you may not have to answer me right now, but I do think what I would like to do is have a conversation, or have you spend more time looking into the setup downstairs, and maybe come back to the board with some thoughts on whether this was a one-off caused by Munis, and setting aside the DOR issues, right, and all that other stuff. But the calculations, took a long time to get right. And so what we need to understand is, was this just because we were doing a once-in-a-lifetime scrub of all the accounts through Munis, and that sort of caused us some confusion, that's not going to happen again? Or is that because the skill sets we have downstairs don't meet what we need to be doing nowadays? Right, there was, in my opinion, a lot more back and forth with the auditors about what deserved to be in and out versus than there should have been. So what I just don't want to see this happen again. We've had so many years now, I mean, for a long time, I mean, of quick closes, accurate numbers, getting the free cash certified very quickly after year end, that I want to assume this is just a one-off. A lot of things kind of went wrong, but I also want to make sure that something didn't fundamentally break or we haven't outgrown our needs, and we have to think about that more seriously. So I'd really like to just know, is this a one-off, never going to happen again, or does this highlight something that's come to light belatedly that we need to think about more deeply? That's really it. On fiscal year 15, we're going to have it submitted by September. That's a good hard date. And it's, what, 60 days to certify maybe after that? How long does it take to certify after that?
In a typical year, with the books being in order and DOR being in order, a two-week turnaround would
that
be...
That quick? Oh, it's that fast.
Would be good.
Okay.
So we might expect longer than that, but 60 days, I think we should be able to...
And the auditor, I should have asked this up front, the auditor's signed off on this number now? On this $2.4 million number?
No, and that's not... The reason for that is that the calculation of free cash isn't a function of the audit process, but of the certification by DOR. The audit process brings us to the point with the financial statements being in a place that we can begin the calculation of free cash. Mm-hmm. That starts from the undesignated fund balance. But that's the extent to which the audit goes. The calculation is not...
So he doesn't review these numbers before they get... He doesn't review these numbers?
Not the calculations.
You know what I'm saying, directly. I know what you're saying, and I'm just trying to make clear. So when you do the calculations, he doesn't double-check those for you.
The auditor has reviewed the balance sheet and signed off on the balances that brought us to the point to begin those calculations.
Okay, for fiscal year 14 balance sheet. Okay. And has he seen a fiscal year 15 balance sheet yet? Have you got any of that stuff even close to ready?
We haven't got there yet. The fiscal year is actually still, transactions are still being processed until tomorrow.
So to Mr. Sestari's point, and again, not to set expectations, but just understand, this number is going to roll into what will become the fiscal year 15 free cash calculation. And so again, assuming things are kind of average, it's going to be the 2.4 plus another 2.x whatever, right? So it's going to be a meaningful number for fiscal year 15, if all that holds. If it's a standard year, right? If, but I'm just saying.
There's potential for that, but I couldn't speculate at this
point. Okay, fine. Then don't. That's good. Okay. I have no more questions. Anybody else got anything?
Just to that point, though, so as you make that point, the first thing that comes to mind is, okay, but we still have to maintain the fiscal discipline that creates the free cash. Is it too high? Yes. But we don't want to spend to spend. We want to spend for demonstrated need, which has been the motto for some time now. So we just want a message to the organization. We've got all this free cash. We're going to get a little bit more free cash, but let's not, let's still try to max it out, right? Let's not.
Well, it doesn't get appropriate until we're done. Yeah. So.
Right, but I want to be careful not to send the message, okay, we got free cash, and,
right.
The gates are open here. Let's have some fun.
Again, I think a lot of this is just because we're generating more revenues than we expect, and so I think there's going to be reversion to the mean, too.
Yeah.
I'd just like to make one more comment. Mr. Palaika, you, as you always do, you artfully address the elephant in the room. If this past year was an anomaly and a hiccup or whatever because of the new system coming in and this and that, that's acceptable and it's understandable. That stuff happens. But for the purposes of planning and being able to have a smooth town meeting and get things done that we want to accomplish, as Mr. Kamala says, town meeting, that's your Super Bowl, right? And when we have to start taking articles off because we can't approve free cash, then that's a big hiccup. That's letting some air out of the ball, if you will. In the end, the effect of something like this is, you know, kind of a choppy town meeting, not achieving everything we want to in town meeting. And, you know, it's also a little bit of a blemish on, you know, the folks at town hall, our board, and more when, you know, I mean, we've seen the articles, we've seen the write-ups about, you know, the free cash and how come nobody could get numbers. Well, you know, the reason we didn't want to give numbers was because it was a roller coaster ride, and we wanted to make sure that whatever number we published was going to be an accurate one. We did the right thing there. I don't question that whatsoever. But not everybody understands that. You know, people start thinking that we're hiding something, and when all we're doing is really looking for the truth so we can give them a real number. So, you know, let's hope that this is the anomaly, and it's not going to repeat itself. And, you know, let's just move on and do better next year. So, thank you, guys.
Any other questions, comments from anybody? All right, thank you, Chris. That's it, I think, for the town manager's report. Right, Ms. Coelho? You get up? Okay. Future board agenda items, Mr. Catino. Mr. Herr.
Nothing at this time.
Mr. Sestari.
Nothing, thank you.
Chair will entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Present, not voting. That's unanimous. Good night, everybody. Good night.